Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible.com. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at www.audibletrial.com/The Rob Burgess Show. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Hello, and welcome to The Rob Burgess Show. I am, of course, your host, Rob Burgess. Our returning guest is Jonathan Fowler. But before we get to that, I need to take a moment to tell you about our sponsor. For you, the listeners of The Rob Burgess Show podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. A book I would personally recommend, which pertains to this episode, is Them, Adventures with Extremists, written and read by Jon Ronson. Whatever book you pick, you can exchange it at any time. You can cancel at any time, and the books are yours to keep. To download your free audiobook today, go to audibletrial.com/The Rob Burgess Show. Again, that's audibletrial.com/The Rob Burgess Show for your free audiobook. Please consider supporting those who support the show like Audible. You'll be helping me out, and it won't cost you a thing. Another totally free way you can help the show is to comment, follow, like, subscribe, share, rate, and review everywhere the podcast is available. Whether it's iTunes, YouTube, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Google Play Music, Facebook, Twitter, TuneIn, or RSS, you can find links to everything on the official website, www.therobburgessshow.com. You can also find out more about me by visiting my website, www.thisburgess.com. Back to today's show. You first heard Jonathan Fowler on episode 2 and later on episode 10 of the podcast. Jonathan graduated with a BA in history from Indiana University in 2006. He is an unabashed left-wing political junkie. He has lived and worked in South Korea for over 9 years, trying to help the citizens of that great nation, hopefully, talk pretty one day. A quick programming note, the majority of this conversation is about the Republican National Convention, which just wrapped up this week in Cleveland, Ohio. The first two parts you'll hear are from before the convention started, and the third part is from after it finished up here today, on Friday. If you stick around to the end, we do also talk about Pokemon Go and the shooting of Charles Kinsey in North Miami, Florida. And now on to the show.
Hello.
Ja.
Hey, Bob, how are you?
Thank God. I called like 10 times.
Yeah. Oh, really? It's kind of hard to figure out how to dial, international number, I guess.
Right. Well, hey, how are you, man?
Oh, doing okay. Working hard. I've got a class within about an hour.
Okay.
So I may have to get ready for that in a little bit, but yeah.
Well, just
thought we could check in and talk about the convention so far, the Republican National Convention.
I feel like this is when we would I feel like this is when we were in college and we would pregame before a big party. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. I think the party is just getting started, yeah.
This is going to be insane, right? Anyway. But, well, whatever you want to...
Somebody had asked...
Yeah.
Yeah, from what I understand, somebody had asked if if it was going to be open carry, and they said, maybe after all these police have been shot down south, maybe we should not have open carry at the Republican National Convention. And I think, was it John Kasich said,
mm-hmm.
No, we cannot, countervene the law. People are allowed to carry guns. So
right.
I think the potential for political violence or any other kind of violence at the Republican National Convention is huge, right? It could be huge.
Absolutely.
Yeah. They know. And the Republican National Convention inside needs to be a gun-free zone, and they know damn well why that is. So. So.
Yeah, it's
Well, I just checked the news a bit ago, and I realized that the convention had started because there was a thing about I watched a short clip of Stephen Colbert crashing the convention.
Welcome back, everybody. Thanks so much. You know, folks, these conventions can be fun to watch, but the people involved, it is a blood sport that we just watch. It is bare-knuckle brawling. It's like the Hunger Games. No, it's worse than that. It's the Hungry for Power Games. I've arrived at the 2016 Republican National Hungry for Power Games. Quicken Loans Arena, named for a moneylender, so you know it's ruthless. Caligula, let's go. This year's Power Games are a big tent. Of course, all races and creeds are welcome this year, unless you want to go up to the executive suites, in which case, you'll want to use the white elevators. Welcome to the arena, citizens. So grand. They can almost hold Donald Trump's entire head. Yes, let's go. The red carpet, of course, is here to hide the rivers of blood that will eventually pour down from the cornucopia when Donald Trump, flanked by his two eunuchs, takes the stage. By eunuchs, of course, I mean Paul Ryan and Rens Priebus, who clearly checked their balls at the door this election. Naughty. The New Jersey delegation has saved one front row seat for Chris Christie to have the best possible view of the end of his career. Do you want? He wouldn't mind. There you go. 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent. Oh, that's good. Who wrote that? That's fresh. Hello, excuse me.
I'm Hi. About to go live.
You're about to go live?
Yes, we're
All
in the
right.
middle of our show.
Oh, I apologize.
But do you want to...
You're in Telemundo?
Yes.
Did they let Telemundo in here?
Yes, of course.
You didn't have to burrow in around Donald Trump's wall?
No.
There was no wall outside keeping Telemundo out.
No.
Answer a question for me, por favor. ¿Qué es más macho, Donald Trump y Hillary Clinton?
No comment.
Is that Spanish? Because I don't understand not
Sin
answering
comentario.
Questions. That sounds delicious, but I'm all full. Thank you very much. North Carolina has staged themselves strategically next to the bathrooms so they can check everyone's genitalia before they, you know, cast their ballot, shall we say. I have a weasel in my pants. Chuck Todd! Have Matt Lauer washed and brought to my tent. My weasel wants to make love to your goatee. Meanwhile, liberal Washington State has positioned itself near the bathroom's male, female, and I'm gonna say mystery date. Anything goes. There was only one thing left to do, and only one place I was not supposed to do it. This week, in this arena, the Republicans shall prove they are truly passionate about one candidate, Hillary Clinton. They will do anything to stop her, up to and including nominating Donald J. Jonah Jameson Trump. But Tribute Trump will not enter the arena alone. No, he has formed an alliance with Indiana Governor Mike Pence. Sorry, I blacked out there for a moment. So it is my honor to hereby launch and begin the 2016 Republican National Hungry for Power Games! Look, I know I'm not supposed to be up here, but let's be honest, neither is Donald Trump. We'll be right back with more of our live convention special. Stick around!
It's gonna be wild if that's how they're kicking it off.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, there's just so much to talk about. I don't even know where to begin. Indiana has been in the political spotlight like you wouldn't believe. Mike Pence, our governor, is now Donald Trump's running mate.
It's a national shame for our state, I think. I think the one upside is that, you know, he can't run for governor again, so they're going to have to replace him, and he may, mm-hmm. you know, probably the next person could be a Democrat.
Well, even if it's a Republican, we've gotten rid of this guy. Well, that's true, but let me tell you that I have interviewed his rival in the governor's race, John Gregg. Basically, his biggest problem is that Pence was, like, just screwing up at every corner. I can't even tell you how many times he, like, had so many unforced errors in state politics that brought terrible recognition to our state, unnecessarily, by the way.
The two things that come to mind for me are, I mean, these were about a year or two ago, I think, but there was the one where he closed down a Planned Parenthood or something in, like, southeastern Indiana, I believe.
Oh, well, I can tell you about that. It was called by, I don't remember what organization, but it was a government organization, the Sub-Saharan Africa Levels of HIV Infection. And he was morally opposed to any kind of syringe, clean needle program, trade-in, you know what I mean?
I thought it was a Planned Parenthood.
Yeah. Planned Parenthood used to provide testing in these places for AIDS, mm-hmm. and then their funding was cut, and they were forced to close. And they could have stopped this. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, so it was kind of a 1-2 punch of closing down the free the needle exchange program, and then also defunding Planned Parenthood, and so then we had an epidemic of very, very bad things in that part of Indiana.
Well, Mike Pence, by his own words, is a Christian first. That's before anything, and he is a Republican after that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, he's not a great guy. Well, and the other thing I obviously remember about his tenure so far has been the thing where like a year or two ago there was the rights of small businesses to discriminate against homosexuals or, you know, LGBT individuals, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, you know, we're going to kind of enshrine this in law so that, you know, it is, you know, people's quote-unquote religious liberty will be respected.
Yeah.
That they can, basically. And then they had him on, like, with George Stephanopoulos.
That was a national embarrassment for Indiana.
Governor Mike Pence joins us now. Good morning, Governor. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, George. Thanks for the opportunity.
So was it a mistake to sign this law?
Absolutely not. The Religious Freedom Restoration Act was signed into federal law by President Bill Clinton more than 20 years ago, and it lays out a framework for ensuring that a very high level of scrutiny is given anytime government action impinges on the religious liberty of any American. After that, some 19 states followed that, adopted that statute, and after last year's Hobby Lobby case, Indiana properly brought the same version that then State Senator Barack Obama voted for in Illinois before our legislature. And I was proud to sign it into law last week. But look, I think I understand that there's been a tremendous amount of misinformation and misunderstanding around this bill. And I'm just determined, and I appreciate the time on your program, I'm just determined to clarify this. Well, this is about protecting the religious liberty of people of faith and families of faith across this country. That's what it's been for more than 20 years, and that's what it is now as the law in Indiana, George.
But I think one of the problems that people have pointed out is that in Indiana, your civil rights laws don't include sexual orientation as a protected class. And even some of the supporters of the bill who appeared with you when you signed the bill, Eric Miller of Advance America, wrote that it will protect those who oppose gay marriage. He put up this example. He said, Christian bakers, florists, and photographers should not be punished for refusing to participate in a homosexual marriage. So this is a yes or no question. Is Advance America right when they say a florist in Indiana can now refuse to serve a gay couple without fear of punishment?
Well, let me explain to you. The purpose of this bill is to empower, and has been for more than 20 years, George. This is not speculative. The purpose of this legislation, which is the law in all 50 states in our federal courts, and it's the law by either statute or court decisions in some 30 other states, is very simply to empower individuals when they believe that actions of government impinge on their constitutional First Amendment freedom of religion. And frankly, George, there's a lot of people across this country who you're looking at Obamacare and the Hobby Lobby decision, looking at other cases, who feel that their religious liberty is being infringed upon. And the Religious Freedom Restoration Act at the federal level, and all the states now, including Indiana, who have it, are simply about addressing that. This is not about discrimination. This is about empowering people to confront government overreach, George.
Let me try to pin you down there, though, on it, because your supporters say it would. And so yes or no, if a florist in Indiana refuses to serve a gay couple at their wedding, is that legal now in Indiana?
George, this is where this debate has gone with misinformation and frankly,
it's just a question, sir. Yes or no?
Well, there's been shameless rhetoric about my state and about this law and about its intention all over the internet. People are trying to make it about one particular issue, and now you're doing that as well. The issue here, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act has been on the books for more than 20 years. It does not apply, George, to disputes between individuals unless government action is involved. And in point of fact, in more than two decades, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act has never been used to undermine anti-discrimination laws in this country.
Sir, I'm just bringing up a message from one of your supporters. That was one of your supporters who was talking about the bill right there. It said it would protect a Christian florist against any kind of punishment. Is that true or not?
George, look, the issue here is, you know, is tolerance a two-way street or not? I mean, you know, there's a lot of talk about tolerance in this country today having to do with people on the left. But here Indiana steps forward to protect the constitutional rights and privileges of freedom of religion for people of faith and families of faith in our state. And this avalanche of intolerance that's been poured on our state is just outrageous. You've been to Indiana a bunch of times. You know it. There are no kinder, more generous, more welcoming, more hospitable people in America than in the 92 counties of Indiana. And yet, because we simply stepped forward for the purpose of recognizing the religious liberty rights of all the people of Indiana, of every faith, we suffered under this avalanche for the last several days of condemnation, and it's completely baseless. It's not based on any fact whatsoever.
I completely agree with you about the good people.
And I think people are getting tired of it, George. I really do.
Perhaps.
Tolerance is a two-way street.
So when you say tolerance is a two-way street, does that mean that Christians who want to refuse service, or people of any other faith who want to refuse service to gays and lesbians, that it's now legal in the state of Indiana? That's a simple yes or no question.
George, the question here is if there is a government action or a law that an individual believes impinges on their religious liberty, they have the opportunity to go to court, just as the Religious Freedom Restoration Act that Bill Clinton signed allowed them, go to court, and the court would evaluate the circumstance under the standards articulated in this act. That's all it is. And when you see these headlines about Indiana, a license to discriminate in Indiana, and it just, I'm telling you, George, it is a red herring. And I think it's deeply troubling to millions of Americans and frankly, people all across the state of Indiana who feel troubled about government overreach. This isn't about disputes between individuals. It's about government overreach. And I'm proud that Indiana stepped forward. And I'm working hard to clarify this. We're reaching out to business leaders. I'm pleased to be on your show speaking across the country on this. We are determined to make it clear that what Indiana has done here is strengthen the foundation and the constitutional First Amendment rights of religious liberty of our people.
I'm trying to get that same clarity. And it sounds to me like what you're saying is that someone could use their religious faith as a defense against any kind of a suit brought there. But let's try to get to that clarification. You're talking about one fix that people have talked about is simply adding sexual orientation as a protected class under the state civil rights laws. Will you push for that?
I will not push for that. That's not on my agenda, and that's not been an objective of the people of the state of Indiana. And it doesn't have anything to do with this law. I mean, George, Bill Clinton signed the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in 1993.
I remember
then
that.
Then state senator, I bet you do, then state senator Barack Obama voted for it when he was in the state senate of Illinois, the very same language. This isn't about individual rights or preferential rights for anyone. It says that everyone has the right to the highest level of review if they feel that the government has impinged upon their religious liberty.
That gets to the second possible fix.
But I go back again. I really believe, George, that it has been breathtaking to many in Indiana, me included, at the fact that Indiana joined some 30 other states and all 50 states in our federal courts by enacting the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. And yet, from people who preach tolerance every day, we've been under an avalanche
of intolerance. But, sir, it's not just outsiders, sir.
I'm not going to take it lying down.
The CEO of Angie's List in your state has put his expansion plans on hold because of this law. But let me then get to another possible fix. This comes from the Land Legal Defense Fund, and maybe this is the kind of clarification.
I really believe that is a result. I mean, I've been in touch with corporate leaders both outside the state. I've been in touch with Mark Emmert at the NCAA. We've been doing our level best, George, to correct the gross mischaracterization of this law that has been spread all over the country by many in the media. Some of the media coverage of this has been shameless and reckless, and the online attacks against the people of our state, I'm just not going
to
stand for
that. That may be. We've tried to be responsible as well, but let me try to get to this clarification. One suggested fix to the law would say that this chapter of the law does not establish or eliminate a defense to a claim under any federal, state, or local law protecting civil rights or preventing discrimination. Is that the kind of clarification you're talking about?
George, look, we're not going to change the law, okay? But if the General Assembly in Indiana sends me a bill that adds a section that reiterates and amplifies and clarifies what the law really is and what it has been for the last 20 years, then I'm open to that. But we're not going to change this law. It has been tested in courts for more than 2 decades on the federal level.
Let me just ask
in some 30 states, and it represents a foundational protection for individuals. And I got to tell you, George, there's a lot of people in this country who are concerned about government overreach into their religious liberty. And I'm one of them, and I stand with them. And we've defended them in Indiana and made sure our courts in Indiana use the highest standards, the same standards that are in the federal courts in the Religious Freedom Restoration
Act. This
is about protecting liberty of every Hoosier of every faith.
Final question, final yes or no question, Governor. Do you think it should be legal in the state of Indiana to discriminate against gays or lesbians?
George,
it's a yes or no question.
Hoosier, come on. Hoosiers don't believe in discrimination. I mean, the way I was raised in a small town in southern Indiana is you're kind and caring and respectful to everyone. Anybody that's been in Indiana for 5 minutes knows that Hoosier hospitality is not a slogan. It's a reality. People tell me when I travel around the country, gosh, I went to your state and people are so nice. I mean, this is not about discrimination. This is about protecting the religious liberty of every Hoosier, of every faith. And we're going to continue to work our hearts out to clarify that to the people of Indiana and the people of this great country.
Yes or no, should it be legal to discriminate against gays and lesbians?
George, you're following the mantra of the last week online, and you're trying to make this issue about something else. What I am for is protecting, with the highest standards in our courts, the religious liberty of Hoosiers. I signed the bill. We're going to continue to explain it to people that don't understand it. And if possible, we will find a way to amplify what this bill really is in the legislative process. But I stand by this law. It was an important step forward when Bill Clinton signed it in 1993. It's an important step forward to keeping the promises of our Bill of Rights and the First Amendment and our Indiana Constitution. And I'm proud that Indiana's adopted the Religious Freedom Restoration Act.
Governor Pence, thank you very much for your time this morning.
Stephanopoulos gave him multiple opportunities to give an answer directly, and he, you know, absolutely gracelessly dodged the question every single time. And so, yeah, again, that was a pretty big embarrassment, I think, for Hoosiers.
Yeah, and then
so this is obviously the guy that Trump thinks is going to help him now. So,
but Trump or his family, because he was trying to get out of this late into the night. Okay, so let me give you the timeline. This has been the roller coaster ride that Indiana's been on this last few days. All right, so Mike Pence flies to New York on Thursday because he has a deadline to meet because he is running for re-election for governor. And Indiana law states that you cannot run for more than one office at the same time. So you have to get off of the ballot for governor by noon on Friday. Okay, so the terror attack in Nice, France happens, okay? So Trump uses that as an excuse to postpone his planned unveiling Friday morning at Trump Tower in New York. Okay, so he delays that
unveiling of his selection.
Right, he delays that to Saturday, but as I said, Governor Pence has to get off the ballot before noon on Friday. Okay, so there is a mad dash an hour before 11 a.m. is when he tweeted out that Governor Pence was his selection. Because Governor Pence's people were probably, like, freaking out and calling Trump and being like, we have to get off this ballot in the next hour or we're dead. You know, we're not going to have anything, you know.
Yeah.
Because he was – I mean, he was in a very tight race for governor. Here's the thing about Trump's VP candidates, okay? They're all people with no political future. Okay, Governor Pence, like as we pointed out, has made so many unforced errors and has put Indiana into the national spotlight in a negative way unnecessarily over and over. Chris Christie was the same way. He is done in New Jersey. Okay. Newt Gingrich is done in politics. Okay. These are all people with nothing to lose. There's nothing ahead of them. So John Gregg, who his only argument, as I'm circling back to when I interviewed him, okay, he... The only thing that he has going for him is Mike Pence, okay? Mike Pence has fallen flat on his face over and over again. He's fallen over his own shoelaces in places that previous Mitch Daniels, and you know I've had my problems with him, of course, he didn't trip over himself, you know what I mean? I disagreed with what he did, but he did it effectively. Mike Pence has put his ideology and religion first, or whatever he considers religion, and he's all tied up with the Koch brothers.
Okay, well, that's probably who Trump is courting with this thing then, because I think it's pretty clear that the Koch brothers have not been too warm on Trump so far.
They've been positively cold on Trump.
This is probably somebody who he thinks is going to shore him up with that part of the party, the regular party,
right?
The traditional Republican Party, such as it is.
Yeah.
Jon Gregg, tell me a little bit about him, because actually, full disclosure, I don't know, when was the election? When did Mike Pence come in? Was that 2012?
Yeah, he was a congressman before, and he ran against Jon Gregg in 2012 and lost by a very slim margin. He won by a very slim margin. Oh. Jon Gregg lost by a very slim margin. He had been Speaker of the House, I think.
Well, from what I remember at that time was that one of my aunts, she's out in Vincennes, Indiana there. Shout out to Ann Brenda. I think she said that she might have gone to high school in Vincennes or somewhere with Jon Gregg. And so I think she sort of knew him personally. And he, I mean, he's a Democrat, and I can understand, you know, in a state like Indiana, a Democrat could still look a lot like a Republican sometimes. So I actually am not too familiar with this guy. And from what I remember, in that election, there were, I think I ended up voting for John Gregg just because he was the Democrat, and I voted a state straight Democratic ticket, which I, you know, a lot of people say, oh, I don't just vote a straight ticket because I'm a thinking voter and, you know, I consider every option. I don't believe them, you know. I mean, when I vote, I go through everybody on the list. I try to find out what their positions are. But most of the time, I just wind up ending voting pretty much a straight ticket anyway. But from what I remember, that year was Mike Pence was the Republican, John Gregg was the Democrat, and there was another guy who was like a libertarian or an independent who had been on Survivor, and I'm trying to remember that guy's name right now.
Rupert Bonham.
Yes. Yes, exactly, Rupert. And if you've ever watched the Survivor seasons he was on, he was a very charismatic guy, very funny guy, and I was a little bit kind of disappointed to hear that he was like a libertarian or something because I think they're a little bit, you know, they've got a couple good ideas, but overall they've got wildly, wildly dangerous ideas too.
Yeah, if you carry but their ideas to their logical conclusion, like I think I'm socially libertarian. Like I don't care what people do as long as they don't like impact me in any way. Like I get that socially, but like economically and like governmentally, it just doesn't seem like a tenable philosophy.
Yeah, we may have to have a – I think it'd be interesting to have like a three-way discussion with you, me, and like a libertarian who wants to talk about their ideas because, you know, I don't want to just beat up on the libertarian ideals without them there to defend themselves. But I, you know, I mean, I can understand for some people why libertarianism is intriguing or enticing in some ways, but I think it's an absolute disaster for a governing philosophy. And if we ever had, you know – if we ever had a libertarian actual leader, I think, you know, people would realize it's not realistic in a lot of ways. It's kind of like, you know, they say, you know, communism is a good idea, but it just never works out in practice. And I think libertarianism is exactly like that. It's just something that would never work in practice. So, but anyways, I was intrigued and I was kind of torn in that election between John Gregg and Rupert. I forget his family name, but yeah, like just because I just recently, like a year or two ago, I'd watched the Survivor seasons he was on. Uh-huh. And he's like, I mean, he's a fun guy. He's a nice guy. He was a, you know, he was somebody you definitely liked while you watched the show. So I would recommend watching the seasons he was on. I forget which season he was on first, but then he was also on the All-Stars season or something. So
yeah, he was a lifer.
Yeah. I need to go back and watch Survivor again. Like, I want to see what the latest season is like. I mean, I know it's kind of the same thing every year, but I tell you what, that show is, there's something, you know, just a desert island, people, challenges, surviving. I mean, there's something very appealing about that to most humans, I think, right?
Yeah, right.
It's a simple formula.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what's the dirt on Jon Gregg?
Well, there's
apologies to Aunt Brenda.
No, it's not really
I'm sure,
dirt.
I'm sure he's a lovely guy.
It's not really dirt so much
on a human level.
Yeah, I mean, you know how Indiana is, right? I mean, you've lived here.
Yeah.
You know, I don't got to explain it to you. I mean, you know, we live in a bright red state. So for somebody
for
like
our listeners, though,
what
for our listeners, though?
Well,
I might have to explain a little bit for the listeners.
Well, I mean, how would you describe it?
I would say, like, I mean, I think for a Democrat to get elected in certain states, you pretty much have to take on a lot of Republican positions.
Mm-hmm.
But just to slightly less extreme, you know, way than a hardcore Republican might.
Yeah.
And if you do that, you might win. So, I mean, I think I can understand why, you know, I think during President Obama's first term or whatever, in his first year or two before he lost the majority in the Senate and the House or whatever, I think a lot of people, you know, wanted him to strong arm a lot of Democrats and get them to, you know, do what he wanted them to do and stuff. And I think I think he should have. But I think it's also true that there are a lot of Democrat leaders from different states out there, and they can't just go along with, you know, left-wing policies. willy-nilly, or they really are putting themselves at great political risk. So,
well, I mean, if you consider the example of Al Gore, he lost his home state of Tennessee, and a lot of people blame that on the fact that he was pro gun control. So, I mean, he wouldn't have needed those people who couldn't see straight in Florida if not for the fact that he lost the only state that people expect you to win when you're a major party candidate.
Shout out to Marco Rubio.
Oh my God, that guy got taken down so savagely. And that's the other thing too. I didn't see Trump coming. I'm freely admitting that.
Okay.
I mean, did you see this coming?
Ever since 2012, I've had an idea in my head, not Trump in particular, but I had the idea that the Tea Party, these upstarts came in and they were like, the old way is not working. We don't want a traditional Republican. We don't want a rhino or a cuck or whatever the hell they call them these days. And, I think Mitt Romney was the last gasp of the rhinos, as it were, when he lost. I think that gave a free shot to say, and I've been waiting for this kind of thing. I said, you know what, next time the Republicans should just run the most out there, crazy, new to politics person they can possibly do. And when they lose, then they'll realize that it's not a matter of because Romney was a traditional conservative, he didn't win, or because he wasn't a real conservative, he didn't win. It's because America rejects their values. And so now I think we are in that position where they've nominated, a birther, a fascist, just choose your adjective, and this guy's that. And hopefully he loses, but I'm not entirely sure he will. I just don't know what's going to happen, but I think he'll lose, but it's I kept waiting during the primary. I kept waiting for him to make a misstep that was going to hurt him, but when he went after John McCain and he said that he liked people who didn't get captured by the enemy, and then he didn't suffer any consequences, and a couple of days later John McCain kind of apologized to him, I was like, okay, it's over. There's nothing this guy can say that's going to sour the public on him.
Well, I mean, questioning the patriotism or heroism of a person that has been a prisoner of war is, I think, a third rail for most people. I feel like if Hillary Clinton did that they would never forgive her.
If any Democrat, there's a lot of things, there's a huge double standard. There's a lot of things that if Democrats did it, whether that's Obama or Hillary or anybody, it would be unforgivable. But as long as a Republican does it, a certain kind of Republican, it's, it's kind of a maverick style or something. So anyways, so I was not entirely surprised by this guy. And I take a slightly negative view of certain aspects of the American electorate, and I don't give them a lot of credit. I don't think that they're, smarter than they appear to be at various times. And so when they're pumping Trump up, I was like, no, that's probably who they really want to support. And, I was, I think Stephen Colbert at one point said that the one thing he likes about Trump is that the Republican mainstream tried to say, this guy's not going to be the guy. And the voter said, no, we're still going to vote for him. He's still our guy. It doesn't matter what you say. We're voting for him. You're not electing you're not choosing our candidate. And I think that's the one, if you want to take a bright view of democracy, that's the one upside, is that people do still, to some degree, have their voices able to be heard at the ballot box on a national level.
Yeah.
But it's unfortunate if their voices are stupid. But who knows? Maybe he'll go ahead. Maybe he'll lose, and maybe Republicans will get this thing out of their system, which is my hope. But again, that's presupposing that they're capable of learning anything from this.
Yeah.
I mean, I think in a way, it's almost like running Trump. It's like they want Hillary to win. I mean, they're almost saying, "Please, Hillary, be our president," by running this guy, because he's such a clown. He's such an unserious candidate, and everybody knows it. So, but on the other hand, I do think Hillary has weaknesses against this guy. So maybe they know what they're doing.
Yeah. There's so much to say. I mean,
Yeah.
I mean, okay. So Hillary would be problematic against anyone else. But
yeah.
I can't work up the enthusiasm that conservatives and ultimate Bernie bros have for, the hate they have for the Clintons. I don't get it. What do you make of that? Here's a question I've not got a satisfactory answer to. Why do conservatives hate the Clintons so much? Because they're so willing to adopt so many of their policy suggestions that it seems like it would be advantageous to just embrace them. And on the other end of it, I don't know why the Clintons aren't just Republicans. That is what I want a Republican to be. Okay, it does no service to anyone to have your enemy be crazy. You just want them to be untrustworthy. You know what I mean? There is a difference.
Well, I think it's very unfortunate that Republicans have been so gung-ho against Hillary Clinton especially, but both of the Clintons to some degree, for such a long time, because I think it's really blunted a lot of legitimate left-wing criticism of Hillary this time. And, anyways, I think one major thing that people didn't like in the 90s was that, you know, they thought that if we vote for a person, that person is going to be the president, which is Bill Clinton. But with Bill and Hillary, they kind of got a couple of equals, basically, who were working together in a partnership in their marriage. And so they felt like that Hillary maybe had more influence in the presidency than she should have had or something like that. And so obviously there's a huge sexist thing there going on. But I think that's part of the I think that's part of it. And the other thing is, you know, there's a lot, I mean, almost everything she says, they recoil from. I mean, the whole thing, like, oh, it takes a village to raise a child, and then they're like, no, it doesn't. It just takes a mother and a father. That's all it takes. No less. You know, so that kind of, you know, pretty much anything she says, they're going to go against it and everything. So.
Yeah.
That was on Sunday night. On Monday morning, I called Jonathan back.
Hey, Jeff.
Hey, Bob, how are you?
Oh, good, good.
I'm home now. I got to go to bed before too long, but yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's the Republican convention rolls on, so.
Yeah, today's the first day.
So the Rob Burgess Show coverage continues.
Yeah, this will be exciting multi-part episode here. People get the whole spectrum. I'm committed to watching the entire. I mean, I'm going to have to go back. I won't be able to see it in real time, but I'm planning on listening at least to all the speeches and everything. So,
yeah. Well, apparently, as I've done some looking into it and everything, and it looks like there's certain speeches you won't be hearing at the convention. For better or worse, because I found a partial list of Republican, major Republican figures who are boycotting the Republican National Convention this year.
Mm-hmm.
And they include all three of the Bushes,
yep.
George H.W., George W. and Jeb, John McCain not going, Mitt Romney not going, and Governor John Kasich not going.
And it's so. His own state.
Yeah, and I think it's pretty unconventional for former presidents of the party not to attend the national convention. I think that's pretty unprecedented. So sends a pretty strong signal about how certain Republicans are feeling, I think.
Yeah, exactly. John McCain is an interesting one, though, because he doesn't seem like he's fully disavowing Trump. He's just kind of not going to the convention because apparently he is in the fight of his life politically in Arizona there, because for once he's got a challenger that he thinks might be able to beat him because, Trump has stirred up so much anger, especially Arizona being a, you know, border state. And that's, of course, where Trump's wall would be, one of the places. So, the Hispanic population and others are not feeling that, and you know, so it's frustrating for me to watch that because, of course, like we were talking about with John McCain, he was insulted by Trump for being a captured war veteran, and he's still not totally disavowing him, not going to the convention, but not totally disavowing him, so...
Yeah, McCain had better figure out how to be a maverick again and quick, I guess.
Yeah.
Because,
right.
Yeah, there's a new maverick in town, I guess.
Right.
You could say.
Well, apparently Sarah Palin's not even speaking at this convention, which I thought if he was going to get anybody, it would be her, but for whatever reason, she's not going to be there, so.
Well, her son was, you know, the last time she came out and supported Trump, like, her son was charged with beating his girlfriend or something at that point, or something. There was some sort of a domestic abuse case there.
Yeah.
And so I think this time Trump said, somebody asked Trump, like, why, how about Sarah Palin? Is she coming? He said, oh, no, Alaska's too far away. She can't make it. So, yeah. I guess, you know, the Trump Force One broke down last week, so maybe he can't fly her in. So, but, I guess probably with her family troubles, maybe she's not the one they want.
Yeah.
Right now.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, it's interesting, though, not only are certain prominent Republicans not showing up, apparently a fair number of sponsorships corporately have pulled out. I don't know if it was just in anticipation of the possibility of violence and protesting or if it's just Trump itself, but for whatever reason, they had to come begging to, I guess, Sheldon Adelson, one of the billionaires that is funding a lot of these candidates for $6 million to try to keep the lights on at this thing because, you know, I can't remember all the companies off the top of my head, but I think some major ones that are usually reliable sponsors have kind of shunned this as well. So,
Yeah, and I think the threat of violence is, you know, I don't think anybody's underestimating that right now, because another part of the story that I got into and I researched a little bit at the Washington Post was that a guy named Stephen Loomis, who is the president of the Cleveland Police Patrolmen's Association, he's demanding executive action on the part of John Kasich to suspend the Second Amendment in the area surrounding the convention. And he said, what did he say? He said, John Kasich could very easily do some kind of an executive order or something. I don't care if it's constitutional or not at this point. They can fight about it after the RNC, or they can lift it after the RNC, but I want him to absolutely outlaw open carry in Cuyahoga County until the RNC is over.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, the new Black Panther Party is planning to bring guns, as are numerous Trump supporters.
Mm-hmm.
So, obviously, the whole thing is a massive tinderbox.
Right.
And the Secret Service says that guns will not be allowed inside the Quicken Loans Arena, but or in a certain area surrounding it. But outside of that, it's, you know, it's open season. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was a tongue-in-cheek petition going around a bit ago that was calling for that ban inside the, you know, the stadium or whatever to be, the arena to be lifted, you know, because if these people, you know, they're always forever saying, oh, you know, this is why this happened, it was a gun-free zone, if only someone had a gun. It's like, all right, if you believe that, then you should feel more safer than anywhere with people just openly carrying firearms on the convention floor. That should be that you should feel just as safe as you could be if your logic holds. But, you know, this, they don't actually believe what they say, obviously, because then nobody wants that, you know, like in reality. So,
yeah. It's good enough for elementary schools. It's good enough for college campuses. It's good enough for everywhere else, but not good enough for Republican National Convention this year. So,
yeah,
I don't know. This may be the wildest convention, you know, since, well, at least the 60s, I guess, from what we're looking at.
68.
Loomis, was at the Democratic National Convention.
Yeah, in Chicago, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, Loomis continues. He says we're going to be looking very, very hard at anyone who has an open carry, an AR-15, a shotgun, multiple handguns. It's irresponsible of those folks, especially right now, to be coming downtown with open carry or AR-15 or anything else. He says, I couldn't care less if it's legal or not. We are constitutional law enforcement. We love the Constitution, support it, and defend it. But you can't go into a crowded theater and scream fire, and that's exactly what they're doing by bringing these guns down there.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, you know, so if you bring guns into this area, he says, you know, the police are going to be looking very hard, very, very hard at you.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess you can exercise your Second Amendment right, but you're probably going to wind up on a couple, you know, federal watch lists or something if you do.
For sure. Well, it was interesting. I don't know if you saw what the Dallas police commissioner said after that shooting there, that he was saying that there were, you know, during the protest, the Black Lives Matter protest, there were several people who were openly carrying, even to the point where once the shooting started, a tweet went out on the Dallas Police Department website, Twitter, that had a picture of one of these people and said, we are looking for this person. They're a suspect. And this person was not a suspect in the shooting, but he was openly carrying in the rally. And, you know, kind of afterwards when you were talking about, you know, what all the confusion was during it, he was saying that it made their job so much more difficult because these people were muddying the waters by openly carrying. You know what I mean? So if they hadn't had that, they could have maybe pinpointed who was doing the shooting faster, but because there was all these people who were openly carrying, like, you have to put your attention in so many other places, you know what I mean? So it's the opposite of being safer.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I listened to your, I think it was 2 weeks ago, I listened to your Michael A. Wood Jr. a second episode with him, the episode 18.
Yeah.
And it was interesting. I remember he said, like, whatever the people want the police to do, we have to tell the police because the police won't do it unless they get the orders from the public, which is apparently their bosses and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the flip side to that is that when you have police officers getting shot and stuff, and the police, if they were to come out and say, hey, there needs to be some reasonable restraints on this, I think that's somebody that a lot of people who are not inclined to listen to any kind of gun control you know, rhetoric would say, okay, well, wait a minute, the police officers who are, you know, great people and everything, obviously, and we have tons of respect for them, they're saying this. I think we can, you know, I think they'd be more inclined to listen to that coming from police officers rather than, you know, left-wing politicians or gun control advocates or anything like that. So
right, exactly. So yeah, it's an interesting time. I'm looking forward to. I mean, I hope there's no violence, of course, but you know, you almost want these people to, like, all right, just the courage of your convictions. You know what I mean? They keep telling us how great guns are, and now we're here. We're at the precipice, and you know, they're kind of like pulling back. You know, when it actually gets real. You know. So.
Yeah, you almost have to wonder if there's an incident or if there are incidents here at the RNC this time, what would be the fallout for John Kasich? Because he said he's not going to do anything about it ahead of time.
Right.
If there is violence, if people get hurt or killed down there, hopefully they don't. But if something like that happens, I mean, it's not going to look good for him.
No.
What does that say about his decision making and stuff leading up to this? So.
Yeah. Well, I mean. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
I think for posterity, we should mention that, you know, there have been a number of incidents recently. I mean, obviously, right now, everybody knows that, but somebody listening to this a year or two later, if they were to do that or something, they might not realize that, you know, basically, like, on, you know, the 5th of this month, the 5th of July, in Baton Rouge, like, this guy named Alton Sterling was shot by two police officers for supposedly brandishing a gun at a homeless person or something, but he was supposedly, he had been selling bootleg CDs or he'd been selling CDs or something outside of a convenience store with the permission of the owner.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next day in Minnesota or outside of Minnesota, a guy named Philando Castile was killed as a passenger in a car, and he was carrying a gun, but he had a license for it, and he didn't seem to have a criminal record or anything. And then the very next day at a outside of a Black Lives Matter protest in Dallas, Texas, Micah Xavier Johnson shot five cops. Well, he killed five cops, and then he shot seven other cops and wounded them, and shot two civilians and wounded them as well before he was killed with a drone bomb, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, then of course, like, just so much stuff has been going on. Then there was the terror in Nice, France, or whatever, and which was a huge incident. And then this, you know, so basically, like, these huge, extremely violent events have just been coming like day after day after day, so that you can't even focus on the news from one before it's getting pushed down by the news from the next.
Exactly.
Of course, after the truck terror in Nice, France, there was the army coup in Turkey, which was put down. And then, you know, right after that, now we've had another shooting in Baton Rouge where this guy, Gavin Long, a former Marine, African-American guy, killed three police and wounded three others in an ambush. So that's kind of the backdrop to the situation where the Republicans are saying, well, no, the Second Amendment still stands outside of the convention center in the RNC thing this year.
Right.
So obviously, like, I don't know. I hope that's not too dry or anything, but that's just kind of a statement of the situation.
No, it's been one thing after the next, like you've said, and like, we haven't even had time to process one thing effectively before we've been deluged with yet another, huge national and world, event. So it's kind of been a hard time to be a newspaper editor, I'll tell you that much. So it's like deciding what the top story is each day has become a real challenge, you know what I mean? So.
Yeah, it's a chaotic time. Let's see. There's one more quote from a guy named Dan Gross, who works for the Brady campaign, I guess. And he said that Governor Kasich owes it to law enforcement and the public to eliminate the obvious additional risk presented by allowing anyone to carry a gun anywhere, anytime outside the convention center.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, anyways.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's pretty much the gun front.
Yeah, yeah.
Perhaps on a lighter note, there's an artist named Spencer Tunick who has convinced 100 women to go nude holding mirrors on Sunday morning facing the convention center.
Wow.
And so he says it's art. He says women who agree to this are brave artist warriors.
Interesting.
So they're holding mirrors over their head, I guess, to kind of like reflect back on the Republican desire to trample women's rights or something.
I'll be looking forward to that, yeah.
Oh, I think it already happened. I think there's pictures of
it. Oh, it happened on Sunday. Okay, gotcha. Let me look this up here.
So I don't know if he has anything else planned, but apparently he has some history of doing this. He's been photographing naked women in public since at least 1995, from what I could tell. apparently he had 7,000 naked women in Barcelona a couple of years ago, and then 18,000 naked women in Mexico City also. But he says in the United States of America, quote unquote, the naked body is viewed as a crime or violence. Okay, so... he wrote calm, focus, and tight on his hand before he started photographing. I guess those are his directions to himself or something. But anyways, he's been planning this since 2013, before Donald Trump was ever a candidate. So, you know, I don't know to what degree this is tailored to Donald Trump or to the recent situation, but, I don't know. What do you think? Is that art?
Sure. Art is whatever you say it is.
Okay. Okay. I don't know. I wonder. I don't. I wonder about that. I don't know.
He's using a different medium than a lot of artists, to be sure. But why not?
Yeah. Okay.
It's like that Marguerite, painting. This is not a pipe. You know that one?
Oh.
It's like a painting of a pipe, and then above it says, "This is not a pipe."
Yeah, I was confused by that one. Is it like, is it not a pipe because it's a painting, or is it not?
Well, I think I could be wrong, but I think what he's trying to say is that it is whatever the artist says something is what it is. You just have to trust their vision, no matter what, no matter how obvious you think it is, and you know what I mean. So you just have to go with whatever they're saying. I mean, he was also had a very certain style that was I'm blanking on the name of his movement or whatever that he was a part of, but absurdist, surrealist, I think. But anyway, yeah, the point being that you have and I also saw in a museum one time, I think it was maybe MoMA in London, I think I was in, that there was just a shelf with a glass of water on it, and somebody put a frame around it, and that was, I think the caption was, it was called Apple or something. Kind of in the same spirit. Okay. So.
Yeah, well, a few weeks ago, somebody had set the glasses down in a museum gallery or something, and then people all started coming over.
Yeah.
And there's the glasses
right.
on the floor.
I think I saw that, yeah.
So, you know, I don't know. Maybe I don't have enough appreciation for art, but I get a little exasperated sometimes.
No, I remember you used to talk about this in reference to, like, you compare it to, like, an M.C. Escher drawing that's, like, super intricate and obviously took a long time. And then it's like, you know, you look at a, you know, whatever, you know, the guy who's the, you know, I'm trying to think of Jackson Pollock or something, you know, just throwing paint at a canvas, and that's art too, you know. But, like, one obviously required a lot more skill and time and effort to complete, and the other one was just, you know, throwing paint at a blank canvas. So
yeah, well, I mean somewhere there's the idea that artists have to suffer, right? Or I mean something.
Sure.
I don't know, maybe. I don't know how much this Spencer Tunick guy is suffering photographing hundreds of naked women. You know, I don't think we could argue that he's suffering really for his art. And I don't know, but I have a feeling. I wonder, like, I wouldn't mind his job, I guess. I mean, if that's a job that you can make a living at, I guess I'd like that for my own reasons. But I think the very fact that I question whether or not it's really art means that I will never convince hundreds of women to get naked on film.
Yeah, that's so. Right. You can't. You think he's like, gee whiz, women, I don't know if this is art or not, but get your clothes off. He probably, you know,
yeah,
presented it a little more. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, what were those videos back when we were in college that were always being put out? Girls Gone Wild or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, maybe he was an artist too.
Yeah.
I think he was a bad man, but, you know, I don't know. Anyway, so I don't know. I question it. I think it's good. I mean, I think it's good, like, that he's protesting in a way the Republican convention or whatever. But at the same time, I'm not sure that Republicans would all think that it's such a terrible thing that there are hundreds of naked women outside the convention center.
So your real beef is that this is really just a reward.
Like,
almost for the Republicans.
You know, I don't know. I think there's... I don't know that it will have the desired effect. So, I don't know. It adds to the overall absolute chaos of this convention. So I guess it's got that going for it. So
yeah.
But you know, yeah. I just don't think the right people will get the right message, though.
No.
I don't think anybody's going to change their stance on birth control or, you know, abortion or anything like that over this. So I don't know.
Well, I saw the women in the mirrors, and I realized I'd been wrong for so long.
Yeah, I saw the women, and I had some dirty thoughts, and then I saw myself in the mirror, and I thought again. Yes, maybe I was wrong.
But wait.
I was a bad man. I don't think
no.
That kind of introspection is going to be on show at Trump's convention.
Mm-mm.
So,
Well, I've got the... Sorry, go ahead.
No, go for it.
I was going to say, I've got the speakers list for today up right now. Convention opens at 1 p.m. Monday's theme is Make America Safe Again. Monday's headliners are Melania Trump. Is that how you say it? Melania?
I guess.
Melania, yeah. Retired General Michael Flynn. Senator Joni Ernst, who was in talks to be Trump's running mate but dropped out and endorsed Pence. Jason Beardsley of Concerned Veterans for America, and Representative Ryan Zink of Montana. So additional primetime speakers include Rudy Giuliani, Alabama Senator Jeff Sessions.
Racist bastard.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Willie Robertson of Duck Dynasty. Actors
Never
Scott.
Never watched it, but I'm familiar with their.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm familiar with their, I don't know, their social media over whatever.
Yeah, right.
Over, however you pronounce it.
And this may be the best part here. Actors Scott Baio and Antonio Sabato Jr., former Texas Governor Rick Perry, Milwaukee County Sheriff David Clark, and Arkansas Senator Tom Cotton.
Oh. Okay, yeah, I definitely know some of those names, and I'm aware of them to some degree, but yeah, it'll be interesting.
So Tuesday's theme, Gary, go ahead.
Well, I always wonder if Trump is going to divorce Melania, but I figure I don't think he can, you know. He's got to hold the family values vote, and how's he going to ever get Clinton to come to his wedding again after this? So I think that's got to be his last rodeo. You know?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, man. So Tuesday's theme is Make America Work Again.
From the man who says you're fired. Okay.
Right. Tuesday's headliners are Tiffany Trump, which I assume is one of his daughters, Donald Trump Jr.
Not the one he wants to bang, though, right?
I think that was another one, but yeah, who can keep track anymore? Donald Trump Jr.
Maybe this one's hot too.
Yeah, possibly.
Maybe she'll get naked
and hold a mirror. Yeah, Donald Trump Jr., who I think is the one that shoots lions for fun. Former presidential candidate Ben Carson.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That should be fun to watch.
I can't wait to see that. West Virginia's Senator Shelley Moore Capito, Kimberlyn Brown, and Carrie Woolard. Primetime speakers include Mitch McConnell, Kentucky Senator, House Speaker Paul Ryan, who just has debased himself.
I'm sure that'll be an enthusiastic endorsement.
It's like, yes, I was here. Yeah. Goodbye. New Jersey Governor Chris Christie. Arkansas Governor Asa Hutchinson. Ultimate Fighting Championship President Dana White.
Okay. Well,
and Republican National Committee co-chair Sharon Day.
Speech.
What's that?
I hope Chris Christie doesn't start crying in the middle of his speech. I hear he was pretty busted up that Donald didn't choose him. He's been carrying his water so good lately.
I know.
You know?
Yeah.
He even knows when to get on the Trump plane and everything.
Oh, I know.
Doesn't have to be told or nothing.
Such a good lackey. Okay, so Wednesday's theme is Make America First Again. headliners are Governor Mike Pence.
Shouldn't that not be on the third day of the convention?
I feel like somebody should have seen that at some point and been like, "This is out of order." Governor Mike Pence is speaking on Wednesday,
and saying, I think that saying "Make America Safe Again" on the first day, that's very optimistic about how this convention's going to go. Test the waters first and make sure it actually is safe.
It's more of a hopeful statement. So Newt Gingrich.
Like a warning.
Yeah, right. Yeah, totally. Wow. Newt Gingrich is speaking on Wednesday. Eric Trump, another one of the Trump children, and Lynn Patton.
Which one of the boys of Trump is the one that has like the, they've got terrible hair. They've got like the, kind of the, what do you call it? The mullet thing going on? The yuppie mullet?
Yeah, yeah. The one that looks like Patrick Bateman.
Maybe they both do.
Yeah, it's hard to tell them apart. So additional speakers on Wednesday.
The Trump boy is speaking.
Mm-hmm. Additional speakers include Senator Ted Cruz, who I knew he would come around. He said so many terrible things about Trump, but I always knew it would circle back around for him.
Most of these people did at one point or another.
Yeah, that's true. Senator Marco Rubio, Governor Scott Walker of Wisconsin, Gingrich's wife, Callista Gingrich.
Which wife? Is he on his second or third wife now?
Could be third, fourth, I'm not sure. I think this was the person he was having the affair with while his wife was in the hospital. I could be wrong, but, I mean, he's had so many affairs, you can't keep track. But retired astronaut Eileen Collins, yeah.
I'm sure his wife will be there to speak about family values.
Of course, yeah. And, yeah, how the gays are ruining everything. State Senator Ralph Alvarado of Kentucky, and he will speak about the Republican Party as the party of opportunity for voters of all backgrounds, especially Hispanics, quote unquote.
Ooh,
yeah.
I'm sure things are real good if you become one of Trump's token mm-hmm. minorities.
All right, so here we go. Thursday, final night, theme: Make America One Again.
Make America what?
One, O-N-E.
One. Okay, I wasn't sure if it was win, like past tense. Or
it could be, yeah. That would make sense too, yeah.
So this is distinct from Make America First Again. This is make America One Again.
Well, if you're first, you're number one, right? So, I don't know.
Maybe there's a difference we aren't aware of.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
We haven't been first or number one for so long. We forgot what it means, I guess.
Exactly.
But Trump's going to make us one again so much that we're going to get sick of it, right?
Exactly. We're going to be tired of being one. So, of course, as usual, the nominee speaks on the last night. So Trump speaks on Thursday, along with PayPal co-founder Peter Thiel. And I don't know if you know much about this guy, but he was the one who, I don't know if you followed the Hulk Hogan Gawker case at all.
He's log cabin Republican, right?
I believe so. Yeah, he's gay. Yeah, exactly. Precisely. He was outed by Gawker for being gay. He then exacted his revenge on Gawker by, you know, bankrolling this lawsuit by Hulk Hogan over a sex tape of Hulk Hogan that they had posted on Gawker, and he then successfully won, and, you know, Gawker's pretty much going to be bankrupt if they have to pay this. So, pretty scary.
He's a small business creator.
Right, he's a job creator, for sure.
Absolutely.
Ivanka Trump speaking on Thursday.
Here.
Yeah. So Ivanka's going to get up there. Ivanka is the one I think he said that he wanted to. Yeah. So.
He's going to go up and say that he didn't really actually rape her like she said back in the 80s, right?
Right. Tom Barrack, the CEO of Colony Capital.
Truly an epic.
Yeah.
Okay.
Additional primetime speakers include RNC Chairman Reince Priebus, Oklahoma Governor Mary Fallon.
Is it Reince?
Yeah, it's a hard name to say. I knew how to say it once, but I forgot. And evangelical leader Jerry Falwell Jr., the president of Liberty University.
Ooh. Oh, his dad would be so proud.
Oh, I know, right? So, that is your convention lineup.
Yeah. Well, I think we're, before it's all said and done, we're going to have plenty to talk about.
The final part of our conversation came this morning, Friday, after the convention had wrapped up Thursday.
Hello.
Hey, Jeff.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, good. So, here we are. Here we are at the end of this thing.
Friday evening.
Yeah.
Yeah, what a wild ride it's been this week.
I don't even know where to start. There was just so much. But you sent me a list of things you wanted to talk about, and I definitely thought of a lot of them first, but what do you think the biggest story out of this convention was?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. It's hard to process because it really kind of only ended a few hours ago, I think. But I don't know, you know. Maybe the division of the party, possibly by Ted Cruz. Or maybe he doesn't even represent the party, but, you know, he obviously didn't support Donald Trump. But I think there's, you know, a lot of Republicans who don't want to support Trump, but I don't think they want Ted Cruz to be their standard bearer for that. So. Mm-hmm.
Right. And then there was
that was a big one.
That was a moment at the beginning of the convention where the kind of never Trump people kind of had their last hurrah there, right when they were, you know, adopting the rules or, you know, whatever. And there was a small revolt in the audience from, I believe, the Colorado delegation walked out, a couple others. And yeah, there was a voice vote that was kind of the chair was like, from what I can hear, the gays have it. And it's like, well, I don't know. There seems to be a lot of screaming. I don't know if this is a really scientific way to conduct this, but...
The question is on adoption of the resolution. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, no. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, and the resolution is agreed to.
Yeah, well, that's just like when the Hillary camp did the same thing in Nevada or whatever with the Bernie thing, right?
Right, yeah.
Obviously, they were losing the voice vote. She's like, well, I think the yeas have it or something. Totally ridiculous. Yeah, I think that's, you know, after 2016, we should never trust the voice vote again.
Yeah, definitely not. But that,
obviously,
you know,
whoever's on stage can, yeah, they can just say whatever they want to say about it, what they think they heard.
Right. But Ted Cruz,
I don't think that never Trump was strong enough.
Yeah. They definitely weren't strong enough.
I don't think there was enough protesting. Like, I don't think, like, the protests from what I heard outside the convention were not as big as we might have expected. And, you know, the Never Trump thing didn't really last past the first day. And Ted Cruz is not somebody that anybody wants to rally around. So I think, you know, the opposition to what's happening there with the Republican Party has just not been there at this event.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, the good news is I don't think there's hardly been any violence at all, which is, you know, surprising and shocking based on everything that's going on. So maybe that's the positive takeaway from it.
Mm-hmm. But,
so,
yeah.
Anyway, I'm trying to remember what the last thing we talked about was. I mean, we talked on Monday or must have been Monday night.
Well, we talked Sunday night on my time, Sunday night, and then Monday morning, right before the beginning of it, we talked again. So, yeah, this will be part three. Yeah, it's just hard to process. There's been so much, but that Ted Cruz thing was amazing. That is one of the few speeches I remember I said, on the last part here that I was going to commit to watching the entire thing. And I did watch every single debate, Democrat or Republican, in their primaries. So I was like, well, if I've watched all that, I can watch these conventions. But then I forgot the debates are like, they're still trying to like win people over. And this is just, you know, rallying the troops and stuff. So I watched as much as I could, but I just didn't have the stomach to watch. The first day alone was 10 hours long if I was going to watch the whole thing. So I watched what I could of it. So
yeah, I caught the highlights, watched a few complete speeches. I didn't watch any of the Trump family except for Melania's speech, which she apparently plagiarized from, of all people, Michelle Obama.
Barack and I were raised with so many of the same values. Like, you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, that you do what you say you're going to do.
My parents impressed on me the values that you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, and you do what you say and keep your promise.
That you treat people with dignity and respect, even if you don't know them, and even if you don't agree with them.
That you treat people with respect. They taught and showed me values and morals in their daily life. That is a lesson that I continue to pass along to our son. And we need to pass those lessons on to the many generations to follow.
And Barack and I set out to build lives guided by these values and to pass them on to the next generation, because we want our children and all children in this nation to know that the only limit to the height of your achievements is the reach of your dreams and your willingness to work hard for them.
Because we want our children in this nation to know that the only limit to your achievements is the strength of your dreams and your willingness to work for them.
Which, you know, probably a lot of Republicans will never forgive. I mean, if she plagiarized Nancy Reagan or, you know, Barbara Bush or something, if Barbara Bush even ever gave any speeches,
right?
I think that would be, you know, within the realm of something that would be acceptable for Republicans, but I don't think plagiarizing Obama's wife is going to win them any fans.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, definitely. That was an insane story to begin with, just because, you know, I can't believe that they, I mean, do you think that was intentional? I mean, to distract from other things that was going on? Because it seems so blatant, and, you know, they got to know that people are going to check this kind of thing.
There was even the accusation that she had Rickrolled, or she had been Rickrolled, depending on whether we, you know, whether the final blame comes down on Melania herself or, you know, a speechwriter somewhere. I don't know what happened, honestly. Like, I mean, I heard the two speechwriters that were paid to write the speech, they said the speech she delivered was not the speech that they gave to her weeks in advance or whatever, that she had made changes to it. And then they eventually fired somebody, I think, some woman or something, who said she made mistakes or something. But it was always unclear, you know, to what degree Melania herself was involved in it. And, you know, obviously English is not her first language, but, you know, this is obviously a ridiculous thing to do. But at one point she said, like, Donald Trump is never going to give up on you and he's never going to let you down or something. And people were like, is that a Rickroll? Did somebody just put a Rickroll line in the middle of the speech and she doesn't know?
I did see that.
Or does she know?
He will never, ever give up. And most importantly, he will never, ever let you down.
Never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down.
Yeah, I mean, it's just unbelievable. But everybody thought she gave a good speech except for the part that she plagiarized.
Mm-hmm.
So then there are all the things, you know. Well, you know, Chris Christie said something like, oh, well, you know, 93% of the speech was not plagiarized, so that's pretty good, right?
I'm going to remember that one if I ever get caught for plagiarism. Most of it was mine. I put my name on it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good enough for presidential candidates' wives, apparently. So.
Yeah, right. Well, I think that person in the Trump, camp that took the fall. I think. I mean, I don't really know that we can put the blame on that one speechwriter. I feel like, even if that one speechwriter did do that, I mean, there had to have been other people who saw the speech or figured out what was going on, or I don't know. Like,
I mean, who knows what? Who knows who knew what? I mean, it seems like everybody says that Trump doesn't have enough people, and the whole thing has been kind of thrown together willy-nilly, and like, so it's entirely possible that they never really did bother to check this for some reason. So
yeah,
and you know, and that comes back to Ted Cruz too, because Donald Trump says that he had a copy of Cruz's speech unedited like 2 days before or something, and he gave the go-ahead. He's like, if Ted Cruz wants to commit political suicide, then that's his choice to do, and it's not going to hurt me. So he said he allowed the speech, even though he knew it was going to be in it.
Right, right.
So,
well, that was the one of the few speeches I watched all the way through. That was crazy. That was just insane. I mean, first of all, like you said, I mean, the Trump camp had to know what was happening, because, you know, we knew that how Cruz felt about Trump, and I always sort of thought Cruz would eventually come along, but, you know, I guess he's still trying to establish himself for the 2020 presidential run as the outsider to Donald Trump or whatever. So I guess
I can remember ever since 2011, it feels like, with all the government shutdowns and stuff, and it seems like that was about when I started hearing about Cruz and stuff. And And Ted Cruz has always been reaching beyond, you know, the interests of the party, more in favor of his own interests and stuff. And I think that, there are four different ways to look at, I think, what Cruz did, possibly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, number one, it was funny. Did you see the video of the Trump plane landing in the middle of one of Cruz's speeches earlier, right when he was talking about Trump, and then Trump's plane flies right behind him?
No, I didn't see that.
He just upstaged me. No, you got to watch that. It was hilarious. He was just talking about Trump, and he hears a howling sound like a jet engine, and then the Trump plane comes into the runway right behind where he's speaking and, like, drowns him out a little bit. And so then I think, like, a day later or later that day, he gave his speech. But like I said, I think there's four different possible interpretations of what Cruz did, and I don't think anybody really knows what the correct interpretation is. And I think, one hand, it could be like a principled stand and last gasp for the never Trump right.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I don't think anything that Cruz does is truly principled.
Mm-hmm.
Or it could have been a self-serving announcement speech for the Cruz 2020 presidential campaign. And, you know, Cruz is such a sniveling lickspittle. I think lickspittle is a noun, right? That's a word we can use.
It sounds kind of old-timey, but I'll take
the type
it.
Of person he is.
Yeah.
I think that's a very fitting application we can apply to Ted Cruz. Or it could have been, you know, righteous revenge for Trump threatening to, quote-unquote, spill the beans on Heidi Cruz, Ted Cruz's wife, which, with the perhaps almost sexual implication of what that was, and then accusing Cruz's father of being involved in the assassination of John F. Kennedy. I mean, he claims that these were the things that really set him off, and, like, he could never forgive Trump for it, and so he would never endorse somebody who insulted his family like that.
Mm-hmm.
And he also, you know, said that Heidi Cruz was ugly and Melania was attractive, and so, you know, which is just bizarre for a presidential candidate to do.
Yes.
So there's, you know, there's the possibility that I think that probably played some role in it, but I don't know that that's the primary thing that played the role in it. I think most politicians can get behind that kind of petty stuff eventually if they really care about the party and they really want to win and they, you know, really are being selfless and stuff. And the other interpretation that a lot of Republicans are saying is that it's a just profound betrayal of the pledge that Ted Cruz took, but, you know, Donald Trump notably did not take at the beginning of the campaign to eventually come around and support the eventual Republican nominee. And they're saying, well, he said he would, and then he didn't, so he betrayed his word, which is true, but at the same time, like, the Republican primary got extremely, extremely personal in a lot of ways and stuff, and so I don't know, you know, if people can come back from that. Maybe they can, maybe they can't, but
yeah.
So anyways, I think those are kind of four different ways you can read Cruz's behavior.
Yeah.
And I don't know what the correct interpretation is exactly, but yeah.
Any of those is plausible. It's funny that you mentioned that thing about Trump upstaging him with the plane there at the end. As Cruz's speech is kind of going down in flames, because, you know, the audience, it slowly dawns on them what's happening. You know what I mean? It feels like he's kind of like indoors at the end, you know what I mean? He keeps, like, kind of building towards it, and then when he comes out with the line, I forget what it was, vote your conscience or whatever,
vote
instead of
conscience.
Vote for Trump.
No, they don't. Republicans don't like that. Not one bit.
Yeah, they started losing it at that point, and he was really losing the room.
If you love our country and love your children as much as I know that you do, stand and speak and vote your conscience. Vote for candidates up and down the ticket who you trust to defend our freedom and to be faithful to the Constitution. Of the New York delegation.
And then the endorse Trump started, and then as soon as they then it just kind of shortened to Trump, and then and near the end of his speech, and Trump or Cruz is trying to come back to the theme or whatever of the little girl who her father was killed, and you know we got to give her a better American stuff. No one's paying attention anymore because Trump, at you know the edge of the stage or in the back or whatever, has appeared just randomly, totally stealing any attention away from Ted Cruz, and Ted Cruz basically ends with no one paying attention to him, and he just kind of walks off.
And he's still smiling. He's like, yep, I did it. I'm great for 2020. I'm ready to go.
He's like, nailed it.
See. He's like, they hate me now, but they'll realize I was right later.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
That smarmy bastard.
Yeah, for sure. Well, all he did is basically make Mike Pence look normal by comparison later. Because that was supposed to be Mike Pence's big night, is the night that Cruz spoke. And then he basically, it was a dumpster fire. And then, you know, Pence had to play cleanup. So, and anything that wasn't that was probably going to look good by comparison. So, yeah, so that Melania thing and the Cruz speech. Did you catch any of the Trump speech at the end there?
Oh, I think I watched all or most of the Trump speech. But before we get to that, what about the Carson speech and the Christie speech and the Giuliani speech?
I didn't actually watch any of those. What did you think of those?
Well, the Giuliani one I caught clips of, and he was extremely manic. I mean, he was, like, totally amped up and everything and using way too much energy. I don't really remember anything that he said, but he was really manic when he was up there. And Chris Christie held, like, a mock trial of Hillary Clinton because, you know, his big thing is he used to be a prosecutor, and so he's going to prosecute Hillary Clinton. And so he's like, well, she's all this stuff, and isn't she guilty? And everyone's like, yeah, guilty. He's like, shouldn't she be thrown in jail? And I'm like, yeah, throw her in jail.
So we must ask this question. Hillary Clinton, as an awful judge of the character of a dictator and butcher in the Middle East, is she guilty or not guilty? Next in Iran. She launched the negotiations that brought about the worst nuclear deal in history. Let me be clear. America and the world are measurably less safe and less respected because of the Iran deal that Hillary helped cut. Period. After she launched those negotiations, she became the biggest cheerleader for this agreement in the end. It's a deal that will lead to a nuclear Iran, an Israel that will be less safe and secure, and a much more dangerous Middle East. So let's ask it, Hillary Clinton, as an inept negotiator of the worst nuclear arms deal in American history, is she guilty or not guilty? Next.
And then, Ben Carson said Hillary's role model is this Saul Alinsky guy that all the conservatives hate, who I'd never heard of until the conservatives started bitching about him.
Mm-hmm.
But apparently he was some sort of a community organizer. I think he was a Russian Jewish guy or something. But anyways, Ben Carson said that in his book, in the dedication at the beginning of his book, he dedicated the book to Lucifer, which is apparently not true. He dedicated this book to somebody else in his family or something, but he mentioned early in the book that, like, Lucifer was the original person who rebelled and formed his own kingdom of hell, I guess, or something. And he was using it as, like, some sort of a story at the beginning of this book or something. But
now, one of the things that I have learned about Hillary Clinton is that one of her heroes, her mentors, was Saul Alinsky. And her senior thesis was about Saul Alinsky. This was someone that she greatly admired and that affected all of her philosophies subsequently. Now, interestingly enough, let me tell you something about Saul Alinsky. He wrote a book called Rules for Radicals. On the dedication page, it acknowledges Lucifer, the original radical who gained his own kingdom. Now think about that. This is a nation where our founding document, the Declaration of Independence, talks about certain inalienable rights that come from our Creator. So are we willing to elect someone as president who has as their role model somebody who acknowledges Lucifer? Think about that.
So anyways, yeah, Bill said, or Ben Carson said that Hillary's role model is Lucifer, or somebody who acknowledges Lucifer. And so if America allows that to take hold, then God will turn his back on America.
Mm-hmm.
You know, bad things will happen to us.
Yeah.
Which is probably what will happen if we elect Trump, actually. But then continuing with the attacks on Hillary, there was Al Baldessaro, who is apparently a New Hampshire state representative and Trump advisor on veterans issues.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that he said Hillary Clinton should be put on the firing line and shot for treason.
Wow.
And so now the Secret Service is looking into him because that's, you know,
that's a direct
dangerous
threat.
Dangerous speech, obviously.
Oh, boy.
So they said, you know, Hillary loves Satan. Hillary is Satan. Hillary should be shot for treason.
Right.
Hillary should be put on trial and thrown in jail. Hillary's guilty.
Yeah.
Benghazi was Hillary's fault. Hillary lied to the mothers of the dead.
Yeah, so I think even people who don't like Hillary, I don't even know if they would go as far as saying that she should be shot. I think that's a little extreme for even some Republicans, you know. So I feel like maybe they overplayed their hand a little bit. Maybe that's a good thing, you know what I mean? Because now it's like the over-the-top nature of these attacks may actually come back to bite them, you know. And I don't know what kind of inroads they're hoping to make with the females this election cycle anymore, but I don't know how you win the presidency without appealing to at least some women.
Well, I think a lot of Republican women will fall in line one way or the other, but yeah, I don't know. It's a mess. Obviously, I think it's a lot of red meat, you know. Republicans hate Hillary Clinton, and they have, you know, 30 years almost, 26 years probably. So They, you know, this is all pretty good for them to hear, I think, for most part. But I'm sure some of them acknowledge it's over the line. But, like, I think, I don't know. I don't think it was an accident that they definitely, on the first day, they led with Benghazi.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, that definitely wasn't.
Well, and then let me see if there's anything else before we come to Trump's speech. I think that, earlier in the week, also, there were some Code Pink activists. One woman, Jody Evans, held up a banner that said, "No racism and no hate."
Mm-hmm.
An elderly couple tried to pull it out of her hands, but she was stronger and pulled it away from them. And then Republican security and everybody came over and tried to cover her up with American flags. And at one point, they held the American flag upside down, trying to block the no racism, no hate message. So I think there's some sort of a message there, some sort of an ironic, I don't know, there's something there.
Yeah, that's some symbolism.
Yeah, two other women, Allie McCracken and Chelsea Byers, one of them held up a refugees welcome sign during the Giuliani speech. So, Anyways, these activists were pretty active in the crowd at certain times and stuff. So,
right. Speaking of the crowd, you mentioned that you wanted to talk a little bit about Alex Jones crashing the Young Turks filming location, which I've seen bits and pieces of. I think we should say that Alex Jones was a special guest of the Trump campaign in the hall. That's how he got in there. And Roger Stone, who's like one of his people that he has on his show all the time, I guess, he worked for the Trump campaign for a while, and then I guess he was fired or something. So, yeah, I think we should take a moment to recognize that Trump is helping legitimize Alex Jones in the sense of being a special invited guest. It wasn't like he snuck in, like he wasn't invited. So
yeah. Well, that was a crazy incident. I think it was just a few hours ago or so, but yeah, the Young Turks were reporting, and I think it was it was Cenk Uygur and Ben Mankiewicz and John Iadarola, mm-hmm. and one other guy named Michael somebody, who he's not a regular, but he's on periodically. I don't really like the guy, but he's kind of like a special guest. I think he's friends with Janky here or something, but so they're talking about whatever they're talking about. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, Alex Jones walks right in front of the camera and walks right in front of the Michael guy and stuff and shakes Cenk's hand. He's like, "Hey, Cenk, how's it going? You planning the revolution? The revolution's still happening and all this stuff." And he's like, "Oh, yeah, it's happening. How are you doing, Alex Jones?" And he's like, "Oh, I'm doing real good. I'm doing real good and everything." And real, you know, aggressive buddy-buddy stuff. And then he says, we got like these Hillary shirts everywhere. You seen our Hillary shirts?" He's like, "No, Alex Jones, I haven't seen your Hillary shirts," or something. He's like, "Well, we got to show you our Hillary shirts." And so he pulls out this shirt out of it, like his friend gives him or something. He's got his, you know, his InfoWars filmers or whatever coming around, like blocking shots and stuff and trying to get their film in there. And so they pull out this shirt that has a picture of Bill Clinton in the style of the 2008 Barack Obama, kind of that profile with the blue and red and white colors and stuff. And at the bottom it says rape. So it's got Bill Clinton's face and it says rape. And Cenk Uygur almost immediately yanks it out of his hands and crumples it up and everything.
Right.
And then he sees that the stone guy is over there too, and he hates that guy apparently. So he started screaming at him and, you know, calling him a hatchet man and everything. And
all right, we're back on the Young Turks. Obviously, a little bit of commotion here. As Alex Jones and a guy significantly worse than him entered the stage here.
What changes in demographics is that he wins white males in such overwhelming numbers that it overcomes every other demographic advantage Hillary has.
How's it going? Hey, Alex Jones, how you doing?
Good to see you, man. You're looking sexy.
All right.
Hey. How's the revolution going? You guys starting the revolution?
We are indeed, Alex. The revolution is afoot. Welcome to the Young Turks.
The overthrow of America is nigh.
I am going to restore American democracy along with progressives and conservatives in this country.
All right. Well, I got to tell you, I am really, really proud to be here with you. It's good to meet you in person.
I don't think
that's... How are you guys doing?
We're doing okay.
You like all our Hillary for prison shirts everywhere?
No, I kind of despise it.
What shirts are they?
I haven't seen any of them.
You haven't seen? Oh, my God. You didn't see me? I don't exist if you didn't see me.
I'm not.
All right, guys. Okay.
Here. Look at this. I got a new shirt for you right here. It's rape. It's Bill Clinton that says rape. Oh, God. Hide that immediately. That's the big no-no that Roger Stone's banned.
All right. You want to take my show over? I'll take your show
over. Sure, go ahead.
Okay. You know what? Who does this kind of shirt? First of all, a sick guy. Second of all,
Bill Clinton's not a rapist, folks.
No, you know who's accused in court papers. You know who's accused in court papers of being a rapist? Donald J. Trump. By Donald Trump, Roger Stone. You know that. It's in court papers.
Oh, yeah.
You're a sick dude, Roger Stone.
I want to have a rant off with you right now.
Assault me all the time. You never give me a chance. Yeah, oh, you know, I should give you a hatchet job. A job
we'll
to respond.
We'll
you're a
come
sick in. Man, Roger
come
Stone.
Come
no,
Roger,
no you're here. The world's
well,
biggest liar. Didn't you admit that you lied about Elliot Smith, sir?
Right
didn't you already admit that?
You're
you
not
piece
afraid of
crap?
Him, are you? You're not afraid of him. Get him in here.
First of all, Alex, this ain't your fucking show.
I don't know.
Roger, it surely ain't your fucking show.
Are you afraid to debate him?
Afraid? Are you kidding me?
No. All right.
Roger, run away.
Roger, don't go. He wants to debate you right now.
I'm not going to debate this guy. You're a hatchet man. I don't know why anyone in the media takes you seriously. All you do is lie. You're known as the biggest liar in media. You're the biggest liar in media.
Don't get too mad. We got to have a...
All right, well, first of all,
he's actually mad. You're actually really upset. I think you should have come to debate. That's true.
All right.
Once you get out of here, Alex.
All right. We got to continue the show.
Hey, man. Nobody watches you. We know nobody watches you. You need the ratings.
Saudi Arabians aren't funny enough, your little jihad.
Hey, first of all, let me explain something, all right? Okay, this is bullshit.
Hold on.
We're against Saudi Arabia, you dumbass. We talk about that all the time.
Oh, really?
We talk about that all the time. You don't know shit. What do you think? The lizard people are in charge?
No.
Is that what you think?
And you're pissed. We're kicking your ass.
Is that what you think?
You're the anti-liberal and you're pissed.
Bullshit.
We're being nice here.
You know what I care about? I care about the American people.
Good. You're the one flipping the house. Anybody hurt on your knife?
I'm not right. Get the fuck off my stage. Get the fuck off my stage.
I'm not
Finally, like, you know, Alex Jones just won't quit, and so finally Jen Cougar stands up and, like, throws down all of his recording equipment on the ground and gets in his face, and there's about to be a fight, and Ben Mankiewicz takes off his jacket, and, like, he's trying to restrain Jen Cougar, and then a bunch of people pour in there, and finally I think some security guards or somebody came in there and kind of separated people a little bit. Anna, she was in there too, and she, Anna Kasparian was in there, and I think she yelled at them a little bit too and stuff. So, but she wasn't in the filming before that, so she wasn't right in the mix at the beginning. But it was a big thing. There was almost a fight. Clearly, I mean, Cenk Uygur went from zero to pissed off in a matter of seconds.
Right. Well, and he'd had Alex Jones on his show before. I've seen clips of where he was. I don't think they'd met face to face, maybe, but they definitely had, interacted before.
And I've watched that, and it was pretty funny because, and I think they've had some drama about who has more, you know, viewers. And I think InfoWars has like 1.5 million or 2 million or something, and the TYT has about 4 million or something like that. Mm-hmm. And so clearly TYT is like beating him. And that was another thing, like Alex Jones came in there and he's like, nobody watches your show, bro. Nobody watches your show. Your show's like got terrible ratings and stuff. And it's like, when clearly it's kind of the opposite. So they've had this thing, and at one point there was a great video where the Young Turks responded to him because Alex Jones did a video about the Young Turks and stuff, and when he did it, he wasn't wearing a shirt, and he goes into what Cenk Uygur describes as a jiggly rage, because he starts jumping up and down and shaking his fat all around and everything while he's screaming about the Young Turks and how their viewership is like less than his or something. So it's a pretty funny video that I recommend looking up at some point.
Yeah.
It's pretty funny.
For sure.
So they've had back and forth, but I've seen them interview him before and stuff, but they always interviewed him from like remote location. He was never actually, he never came to Young Turks sets or anything like that. So.
Right.
His damage was limited. Yeah. But that dude, man, he needs to be on some medication. He claims he has like 50 guns in his house. And I think his 50 guns need to be confiscated. If anybody in this country is serious about keeping guns out of the hands of mentally unstable individuals, Alex Jones should have his guns taken away yesterday. You know, because this guy is totally, totally unstable. Like,
right.
You can watch any video of him, you can see that. And, like, I mean, I don't know. I had a friend, somebody I played some online game with back in Indiana, and he started sending me some InfoWars stuff one time, and I was like, really? Really, bro? Come on. I mean, is the real world that hard to understand that you want to go in for this kind of thing? And he gave me some, like, he said, Google this. He gave me some, like, code word to Google, and I Googled it, and then it pulled up my Google map, and it listed, like, 4 random locations around the world. And I was like, okay, what? It was, like, a really weird, like, thing, and because it was, like, I just searched in Google this one phrase or something that InfoWars is programmed to, like, pull up your Google map or something. And I was like, what does it mean? He's like, you gotta dig deeper or something. I was like, what?
The truth is out there. we got some big information, folks.
And you know what I'm very disappointed about is, like, I mean, you know, like Waking Life and those movies. I forget who the director was.
Linklater, Richard Linklater.
Yeah, I'm very disappointed. And also, what was that Philip K. Dick novel?
Scanner Darkly. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, all those movies that this guy did, he used to have Alex Jones in each one of his movies.
Well, he was only in 2, I think, director. But it was and they were both the rotoscoped ones, so he wasn't actually, you know, it was a cartoon version, but yeah.
It just disturbs me because a clearly gifted director, mm-hmm. has, you know, closely connected himself with this maniac.
Well, to be fair, I think he also is from Austin, Texas, where Alex Jones is based. So I'm sure that even if you don't agree with Alex Jones, I'm sure he's more of a presence in your life than if you were living in, you know, Massachusetts or something. So,
yeah, well, I don't know. I can't imagine he'd be a positive presence in your life. The point. I mean, maybe back when the movies were made, he hadn't gone full, you know.
Oh, I don't know. He was always kind of reaching in that direction or whatever. There's a really interesting book you should read by Jon Ronson called Them, Adventures with Extremists, he also made a documentary of called The Secret Rules of the World, where Jon Ronson, who, you know who Jon Ronson is, right?
Nope.
Oh, he wrote The Men Who Stare at Goats. He wrote...
I've heard of that.
Yeah. Anyway, he and Alex Jones, this is before Alex Jones was Alex Jones. I mean, this is the thing that basically made Alex Jones, was that he and Jon Ronson and a couple other people snuck into Bohemian Grove in Northern California, where the elite leaders have their, like, summer camp romp.
Is this the Vanderbilts or the Bilderbergs or the what the hell the name?
Yeah. It's all the exactly. It's all the same.
The Rothschilds, or sure. Whoever the hell the New World Order is.
Yeah, of course. So this is the summer camp.
There's some really.
Yeah.
Did you ever? I mean, okay. You've got another video you've got to watch of Alex Jones's that you've got to see is this one where he's talking about how Michelle Obama is a transvestite, so Barack Obama is by implication a gay man, and you can see it because her arms are big. And who is that woman who died? She was a celebrity. She died, 2 years ago, 3 years ago or something, and she was kind of an older actress,
mm-hmm.
Very pro-Israel, kind of anti-Obama.
Hmm. I don't know.
I can't remember her name, actually. But anyway, she died, and Alex Jones has this thing where he's talking about her death. And he said, she went in for surgery, and they poured fire down her throat. She was a fire-breathing goblin. Liberal media or something. His voice changes into this dark, evil voice, and he starts cackling like a monster. And he's talking about this dead woman turned into a fire-breathing goblin when she died.
Are you thinking of Joan Rivers?
Yes, that's exactly who it was, Joan Rivers. And he said that Barack Obama and his transvestite wife, Michelle Obama, went into the surgery or something to pour fire down her throat to kill her and turn her into a fire-breathing goblin.
Oh.
So that's the level he's operating at.
Sure.
So but you've got to watch how demented and unhinged this video is. And then you just got to remember that this man owns firearms.
Yeah, lots and lots of firearms. But.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so Alex Jones and Roger Stone crashed the TYT broadcast, and that's just a little background on that.
Yeah.
I don't know. Depending on who your listenership is, I hope we don't have any info warriors in the audience. Although, if there are, maybe you could interview one of them and get to the bottom of it all.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if we want to go that deep. We might find some lizard people down there. You never know.
Bob, I mean, come on, don't talk about the lizard people. I mean, that's us, right? We're lizard people.
That's right.
The secret's out.
Oh man, I shouldn't have said it. Oh boy. Now there was a norovirus outbreak at the convention. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. Yeah, that's, well, the headlines wrote themselves, and they said, it's a shit show, and now it's like a literal shit show and stuff, right?
Right. Exactly.
I was depressed. I was a little depressed that it didn't seem to spread any farther than the California Republican delegation. But, I don't know. It was just, it was like, it's like biblical plagues were visited on the Republican National Convention this year.
Right.
Evangelicals couldn't put it together. So.
Why do you think there were so few protests, though, at the convention? What did you make it? I was expecting more.
I was too, and I don't know if it's a matter of the killings of African Americans and the killings of police, kind of the tit for tat going back and forth with all this stuff recently, I don't know if it was, you know, a fear of, you know, Minutemen and kind of right-wing gun carriers blowing people away. I don't know if it was, I don't know what it was. I don't know if it's just a general despondency with lack of enthusiasm for Hillary and the Republican or the Democratic option. I was, yeah, I was kind of, or I don't know if it was just an effective, like, effective policing keeping them away from that. I really don't know. I think it's interesting. I'm surprised there wasn't more, there weren't more protests.
Right.
And I think there were people out there looking for protests. So I think if there had been sizable activities, I think they would have come to light. I don't think it's anything that was going on that wasn't covered, really.
Yeah. I mean, if you just looked at the amount of media that was there covering, you'd see like 3 protesters and like 100 people with cameras around them. So definitely maybe a little bit more, yeah. More people watching than actually doing. So.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, mentioning the police shootings of black men, I mean, we had the other case on Monday,
mm-hmm.
which was where a black behavioral therapist named Charles Kinsey, was 47, was shot in the leg, supposedly 3 times, although I think it's very, you know, there's the video out there. He's laying on the ground, and he's got his hands up, and he's explaining that he's the behavioral therapist, and this other man is an autistic individual who's run away from the group home, and he's trying to bring him back, and he's playing with a toy truck, and he doesn't have a gun.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't understand why the video, they cut the video out at the part where he got shot. So you never mm-hmm. see him get shot. You see before and then you see after. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, you know, I don't know. I think like, I don't know. I don't know what's going on with that. But I think like that somebody has that footage, I think. And, you mm-hmm. know, I think maybe eventually it'll come out. But it's just amazing, right? I mean, like this guy was clearly not a threat, didn't have a weapon. And was surrendering and was in communication with the police, and they shot him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, and, you know, and I, you know, back in Indiana, I worked in a group home. We had, you know, 700 individuals who we were taken care of, and, you know, so it hits home for me. I mean, I'm not a black man, so I'm not at that risk, but, you know, taking care of them was, you know, at times challenging. At times, you know, they would go off and do things that they weren't supposed to do, and you and other people had to try to take care of them. And, you know, and I just can't imagine trying to do that job and also having guns drawn on me at the same time while I'm, you know, also responsible for an individual who mm-hmm. cannot be responsible for himself legally in a dangerous situation and getting shot.
Yeah. For sure.
And he said he asked in the interview, he said he asked the officer after he got shot, he said, "Sir, why did you shoot me?" And the police officer said, "I don't know."
Yeah, I saw that too. That was pretty amazing. Yeah, there's a few things going on with this. I mean, first of all, you always hear the refrain from people where it's like, just do what the cop says and you'll be fine. Only people that get shot are people that are mm-hmm. resisting or not listening to the cop. And I always listen to the cop, and that's why I'm fine. Well, guess what? You know, sometimes you do everything and you still get shot. So it doesn't, that's not even a good, and there, of course, there were many cases before this where that was true too. I mean, you know, Tamir Rice, for example, yeah. that was a perfect example of, you know, just somebody rolling up and just shooting them for no reason. But, you know, the police, after this happened, after it came out that they shot this guy with his hands up, the police then released a statement saying that they were trying to shoot the autistic person, which is not better, which yeah, is not a better, better answer. I don't know why they thought that was going to be like, oh, okay, well, as long as they were trying to shoot the mentally handicapped person, well, that's great. No, so,
They said they thought that the toy truck that he was holding was a gun, even though the you know, the behavioral therapist guy, Charles Kinsey, was obviously saying that he's got a toy truck, and he's like saying, "Ronaldo, sit down, Ronaldo, lay down on the ground." But, you know, you can't always make people do what you want them to do in that situation, you know. They're mm-hmm. in their own world to some degree. And so, you know, obviously verbal cues by themselves don't always get it through. And, you know, it was an out of control situation, but it was not a dangerous situation, you know. And obviously, like, I think part of police training that's been talked about before is dealing with people with mental disabilities. And mm-hmm. I think, you know, autism is clearly, I mean, you know, I mean, that was a pretty clear case of, okay, this guy's not dangerous, but he's not responding the way a normal person would. And, let's stop and think about that for 5 seconds and think about what could possibly be going on. And it wouldn't take too long to figure out something close to what the truth was. And now John Rivera, who's the president of the Miami-Dade County Police Benevolent Association, says that, quote unquote, the movement of the white individual looked like he was getting ready to charge a firearm into Mr. Kinsey. And the officers, who continue to be unnamed, discharged trying to strike and stop the white male. And unfortunately, he missed. Okay. Well, number one, that's bullshit. And we know it's bullshit because, number one, since when do police stop shooting before they hit their target? If the target was the white male with the toy car, why did they stop shooting after they shot the black guy three times? Obviously, if this guy was the danger, they're going to keep shooting until they hit him, and then they're going to, you know, try to take care of the black guy. Number two, why did they handcuff the black guy and flip him over on his face and leave him bleeding on the pavement for 20 minutes if he wasn't the target, if he was the one they were trying to protect? It's obvious, stupid bullshit. And so, you know, so they're obviously lying. And number three, you know, gun rights people are always, you know, they're obsessed. They're absolutely obsessed with, you know, trigger control. And, oh, did you take a picture with your gun? Oh, is your finger on the trigger? Oh, you're an irresponsible gun owner and you don't know how to handle guns. And you need to go back for training and yada, yada, yada. And look at me. When I'm holding my, you know, AR-15, I always keep my finger pointed and it's never on the trigger. Clearly, these police were, like, in a situation where they were not threatened. Nobody was threatened. And they shot the wrong guy who they were not, supposedly they were not aiming for. I mean, it's like either these guys are incompetent and never should have had a gun, or they were trying to shoot the black guy. Right? I mean, like, those are the only two explanations.
Right.
And neither of them look very good.
No. Yeah,
it just comes to the point where it's like anytime the police have a gun pointed at a black guy, I mean, is it like, there's some sort of a subconscious magnet that just, you know, their fingers automatically pull the trigger. I mean, it's like they can't help themselves at this point. There's good cops and bad cops out there, but this is just, after the last several weeks that we've had, it's amazing that this kind of a stupid shooting could happen right now.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, you could also say that, you know, we've failed mental health so badly in this country that we've almost kind of left the police to be the only ones to clean up the mess or deal with mentally handicapped people. And, you know, and this is what you get because people obviously don't know how to deal with the situation or, you know, like you said, like none of the options are good. So, I mean, do you think that is that argument persuasive at all to you that police are just asked to do too much?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, Charles Kinsey was trained and left to deal with the behavioral issues of a mentally handicapped individual, but he was not allowed to do his job in public.
Right.
So, you know, I don't think it's like, I think part of the police training needs to be dealing with the de-escalating situations and dealing with, you know, people who are not just mentally handicapped, people who are suicidal or people who are, you know, there was another shooting in California, I think last week of somebody, they were chasing somebody, they pulled over the wrong guy and he didn't comply with them fast enough. And his lack of compliance was maddening to watch, but then they shot him multiple times and they, you know, and they killed him. But he said before they killed him, he said, I hate my life. And then he started walking towards them and they shot him to death. Well, they shot him on the ground. And then after they shot him in the chest with a shotgun or shot him in the belly or the chest, his hands probably instinctively went toward his chest and said, get your hands away from your belt. And then they shot him some more until he died on the ground. It's like, okay, number one, you're chasing the wrong guy. And obviously this guy had some serious mental issues, which is why he, you know, maybe it was suicide by cop or something, but when somebody tries to suicide by cop, if they don't have a weapon, and if you've got them already shot on the ground, and you could rush in and, you know, it's just, you don't have to oblige them, you know? If somebody wants to suicide by cop, and they don't have a weapon, obviously, and you've already hit them and disabled them to some degree, you know, I don't know. I don't want to see, you know, police officers put in more risk than they have to be, but part of it, it's a risky job. And once you've already shot a guy on the ground with a shotgun, and you've got several people covering him, I think somebody could run in, pull the hands away and just say, okay, did this guy have any weapons? And if not, what do we need to do now? Mm-hmm. We then got to shoot him some more.
Yeah, I think some of the maddening things to watch with these videos, as you've kind of pointed out, is the not just the response during and you know, before the shootings, is the kind of lack of concern for the people after. You know, if you go to Tamir Rice, you know, his sister, you know, runs up after he's shot, and they handcuff her. And, you know, she's stuffed and cuffed, and she's just running over because her brother just got shot. And, you know, you see Eric Garner getting choked out in New York City, and yeah, he's just laying there, and no one seems very concerned. No one's really taking any quick action to see if this person's okay. Maybe they really were telling the truth about not being able to breathe. You mentioned this guy, the Kinzig guy, getting handcuffed face down in the middle of the street after he's shot. Mistakenly, apparently, allegedly, you know, it's just, yeah.
And I think I can understand that from the CYA perspective, cover your ass, right?
Right.
Like, if you've shot this guy mistakenly and he doesn't have a gun and you were aiming for the other guy, it's probably in your interest to cuff this guy, make him look like he might have been doing something wrong, hope nobody was filming on their camera so you could spin a story. And, you know, make out like, oh, well, he did something suspicious, and that's why we had to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I can understand, and, you know, like the guy who got shot in the car the other day. I mean, like, they handcuffed his girlfriend, and they took his daughter out of the car and stuff like that. I mean, like, handcuffing the girlfriend, it didn't appear that she had done anything except film the incident.
Mm-hmm.
But it was, you know, it's just infuriating to watch. It's totally ridiculous, and it seems like they can't control themselves at all.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know, killing the cops and stuff in retribution, or, you know, that's not acceptable either. But I don't know, you know. I think when people see this kind of targeting and they experience this targeting in their own lives for so long, I think it's you know, to not expect that there's going to be some blowback from that is unrealistic.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of, yeah, it's almost amazing that more hasn't happened. I mean, of course, like we said, it's horrible that, you know, the thing in Dallas and, of course, the thing in Baton Rouge where police officers have been specifically targeted. But that's another thing I wanted to say about those particular incidents. Let's not forget that those people also had mental issues directly related to the fact that they were military veterans. Both the shooter in Dallas and Baton Rouge had done tours of duty overseas in Iraq and Afghanistan and things. So let's not forget that's a definitely, you know, there we have mental illness playing into this again, and PTSD, I'm sure. You know, you mix that up with guns and all these videos, and it just seems like a recipe that is just bound to happen, you know what I mean? And we don't take care of people in this country, especially veterans, and, you know, with as many freely available guns as there are, it's like, yeah.
Yeah, and I would say with the Dallas shooting, one thing that struck me was that, you know, somebody on Twitter somewhere said bad cops are getting good cops killed. Mm. And I think that's correct, because by all accounts, from what I saw, the Dallas police seemed to be doing a pretty good job. I mean, they were taking photos with the protesters. Mm-hmm. They were, you know, they're regulating the protests, but they seem to be, you know, not cracking down or anything like that. And so, you know, those cops were not the cops who did some of these other things. So obviously the violence was misdirected hostility, and it, you know, targeted the wrong people. And, yeah, the whole thing is just turning into a huge mess.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, people on both sides need to, you know, slow down, you know, stop killing people, really look at de-escalating situations. And I know that's probably hard to do if you're a police officer and you've seen all these police officers get killed over the past few weeks. You may not be in the mode to, you know, de-escalate when you're dealing with African-American, you know, suspects or individuals that you just happen to be interacting with in the community, but, you know, at some point, somebody's going to have to take some risks in order for it to get better before it gets worse.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's only two ways it can go from here.
Yeah. What do you make of the All Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter kind of dichotomy?
Well, I think it's, you know, obvious that Lives Matter is kind of a joke. I mean, like, we all know what it means. It means, you know, shut up, stop talking about it, you know, stop pretending you're special. But the thing is, like, I mean, like, you know, we all see what's happening. We all know that, you know, based on studies, people are more likely to associate, including a lot of people are more likely to associate negative things with African Americans. Like, they do these, you know, scientific studies where they test your association of positive and negative words with black or white individuals, and everybody, including African Americans, is quicker to associate the negative things with the African American images.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not even a police issue. It's, you know, it's a societal issue. And, you know, there's a lot of studies that have been done about, you know, rates of violence, rates of fatal violence against African Americans considered to be threats and stuff by police versus white individuals considered to be threats. We've all seen the videos where they'll talk for 20 minutes to a white individual carrying an assault rifle, but they, you know, they won't even give Tamir Rice 2 seconds to explain that he's got a toy gun before they shoot a 12-year-old kid to death on the playground.
Right.
You know, and that's just one incident. That's, you know, or a couple of incidents with the white individuals being talked down by, you know, police officers who are bending over backwards saying, you know, we know you got your Second Amendment rights. We know it's your right. We just want you to calm down and put the gun down. Let's just talk, you know. It's like, and, you know, it's just, you know. So I think obviously the Black Lives Matter stuff is a response to that. And people who try to muddy the waters by saying, well, you can't just say Black Lives Matter, all lives matter. Can't we all be equal? Isn't that what we want? Like, I mean, obviously they're trying to muddy the waters and just, you know, just distort the issue to the point where Black lives don't matter anymore. So.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like a quote I heard the other day. It was saying that, like, you, if you've had supremacy, if you've been in the front seat for long enough, anything that feels like equality is going to feel like oppression to you.
Look at the Sunnis in Iraq. Yeah. They sure as hell didn't want to give up any power.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now we have ISIS.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, you didn't catch anybody saying all lives matter before Black Lives Matter started, nor did you say, like, you know, nobody had Straight Pride Day before there was, you know, Gay Pride, and you know what I mean? It's just like any time there's a minority group that tries to stand up for their rights, these same people will just be like, but isn't everyone? It's like, you know, it's like running through a cancer ward and yelling, you know, there are other diseases, you know, like...
Yeah, well, there's that one comic on Facebook that goes around sometimes or whatever where there's a guy standing with a fire hose in front of two houses, and one house is on fire, and, like, he's, like, spraying the house that's not on fire, and they're like, dude, my house is burning, why don't you spray my house? And he's like, well, my house needs water, too, I mean, why shouldn't I protect my house? He's like, well, your house isn't on fire yet. And he's like, well, if I spray water on it, it probably won't catch on fire, so that seems like the logical thing to do. And he's like, and finally the other guy's house burns down, which, yeah. You know. Obviously, yeah. I mean, you know, you've got to direct your energy and your resources to the place where the problem is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
And even, like, when you say, you know, Black Lives Matter, All Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter, I mean, like, in Baton Rouge the other day, I mean, at least one or two of the cops who were killed or shot, one of the guys who was killed was a black police officer who had posted about this stuff and how conflicted he was and how, you know, when he's in his police uniform, he gets shit from the community, and when he's not in his police uniform, sometimes he gets shit from other cops who don't realize he's a cop, and so he's really stuck in the middle, and he gets blown away for, you know, being in his police uniform. So,
yeah,
you know, even Black Lives Matter, All Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter, none of these things are necessarily exclusive. So when you try to, you know, speak in absolutes and say, well, this one is more important than that one, it's just a muddy water. It's just a messy situation.
Yeah, and
I'm kind of rambling. But
no, that's good that we're talking about this. I definitely wanted to, but you know, with the Blue Lives thing, it's like, there are no, like, as I've seen it pointed out, there are no blue lives. I mean, you can quit being a police officer. You can't quit being black. Like, you're going to be black no matter what. You know, you can't, it's not a job you can be hired for or fired from or resign from, you know. So, I mean, that's a little bit of a false thing. But, yeah.
And at the end of the day, it's a choice. It is a choice to be a police officer. I mean, when you sign up, you know it's a dangerous job.
I mean, like.
And, you know, obviously we want it to be as safe as possible, but, you know, the job of being a police officer is never going to be as safe as you know, a normal 9-to-5 job necessarily. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, where do you draw the line between preserving and protecting officer life versus having a reasonable interaction and relationship with the communities they police? Mm-hmm. You know, I think that's a question that needs to be debated, needs to be dealt with, and needs to be, you know, obviously, eventually you want to improve the relationship between the police and the community. And, you know, putting all the value on the life of the police and none of the value on the lives of the black members of the community, well, we see what that's getting us, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. Exactly. Well, hopefully we can go a few days without any more of these. But, yeah, I think you're right. I think both sides need to take a step back and would not escalate this anymore if possible. But was there anything else about the convention you wanted to get to? I noticed that Peter Thiel, I don't know if you saw his thing about being gay. He said he was proud to be a Republican, proud to be gay. Apparently they had a big, you know, big standing ovation for that. Pretty disappointing for him. But then pretty ironic that these are the same people enforcing, you know, religious freedom bills and these bathroom bills and everything else just to make, you know, LGBT people's lives harder every day for no reason. And they get like one token gay Republican and it's all like, oh, we see, we're the party of Lincoln.
well, they got what's his name? The Kardashian guy or whatever.
Oh, that's Jenner. Right. They do. Yeah. Caitlyn.
Or Caitlyn Jenner.
Call me Caitlyn.
I mean, yeah, well, they've got her now, and she's out there, you know, and said, well, I think the quote from her today was, it was harder to come out as a Republican than it was to come out as transgender. I'm like, come on, give me a break. Come on. And I don't know where Peter Thiel lives or whatever, but I have a feeling he lives in New York or California. Right?
I think it's California, yeah.
Because I have a feeling these, you know, these East and West Coast homosexuals or whatever who think that it's all good. I can, you know, I can be a LGBT and still be a Republican. I don't think that they understand, you know, not to speak for them or whatever, not to put words in their mouth, but I don't think they understand what things are actually like in the rest of the country. They don't know what it's like to have a Mitch Daniels or a, you know, more recently this Mike Pence guy as a governor of your state passing legislation. You know, so and I think it's very interesting, and there seems to be a schism opening up in the Republican Party. And that's one thing I was going to mention about the Trump speech, which is what we haven't really gotten to, kind of the Republican elephant in the room here. One thing that I thought was very interesting about Trump's speech was he was notably not anti-LGBT in his speech. He went out of his way to mention LGBT twice during his speech. And he mentioned the shooting in Orlando. He said 40, quote unquote, 49 wonderful Americans were savagely murdered by an Islamic terrorist. Of course, he's, you know, mentioning the Islamic terrorist part, not the fact that the guy was probably a closeted homosexual himself,
right,
who had some very, you know, conservative, anti-gay, religious beliefs that compounded that situation and gave him a complex about it that led to the violence. But, you know, so, okay, so at least, you know, Donald Trump is throwing a bone to the gay community.
Mm-hmm.
He said, this time the terrorist targeted LGBTQ community. No good. And we're going to stop it. Okay. He was very careful in his pronunciation of LGBTQ. He clearly didn't want to mess that up. He said he would protect our, quote, LGBT citizens from the violence and oppression of the hateful foreign ideology, believe me. So again, he wants to protect them from ISIS, but he wants to protect them from the hateful foreign ideology. He doesn't want to protect them from the hateful domestic ideology,
mm-hmm.
part of which is his running mate, Mike Pence.
Mm-hmm.
So he said after that, the Republicans all cheered and they applauded. And he said, and I have to say, as a Republican, it is so nice to hear you cheering for what I just said. Thank you. And then there was a standing ovation. People were screaming, Trump, Trump, hey, Trump, Trump, hey, like this. So I was like, wow, you know, what the hell's going on here? The Republicans are cheering for protecting and supporting LGBT citizens,
mm-hmm.
granted from terrorists. So he's still playing one minority against another,
right,
as far as the Muslim community in America,
yeah,
and foreigners and immigrants versus LGBT. So, but on the other hand, he's got Mike Pence as his running mate, who is notoriously anti-LGBT. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder, like, I mean, are the Republicans, I mean, did we just see the Republicans who were so wrapped up in his speech that they were supporting anything he said? Do Republicans not really actually care about the issues? They just fall for this cult of personality where the strong man always gets their support at the end of the day? Mm-hmm. I mean, what the hell's going on with this issue, I wonder?
As your president, I will do everything in my power to protect our LGBTQ citizens from the violence and oppression of a hateful foreign ideology. Believe me. And I have to say, as a Republican, it is so nice to hear you cheering for what I just said. Thank you.
Yeah, it's bizarre. Yeah, it's hard to tell. But yeah, it's pretty ironic that, like, that Peter Thiel was like, I think he had a quote in his speech where he was like, and, you know, who cares where you go to the bathroom? Am I right? And it's like, you know, the people that you're talking to seem to care a lot, and they seem to push this issue all the time. Yeah. So if you're looking, look no further.
Yeah, I don't
know. Now we are told that the great debate is about who gets to use which bathroom. This is a distraction from our real problems. Who cares? Of course, every American has a unique identity. I am proud to be gay. I am proud to be a Republican. But most of all, I am proud to be an American. I don't pretend to agree with every plank in our party's platform, but fake culture wars only distract us from our economic decline. And nobody in this race is being honest about it except Donald Trump. While it is fitting to talk about who we are, today it's even more important to remember where we came from. For me, that is Cleveland and the bright future it promised. When Donald Trump asked us to make America great again, he's not suggesting a return to the past. He's running to lead us back to that bright future. Tonight, I urge all of my fellow Americans to stand up and vote for Donald Trump. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks.
I don't know what they would. They might have cut the cameras away from the North Carolina delegation at that point.
Yeah, yeah. So apologies to your home state there.
But I mean, like, I think Donald Trump said a few weeks ago or a few months ago, he said that if Caitlyn Jenner came to his Trump Tower in response to a question, he said she could use whichever bathroom she wanted or something. So Donald Trump, I mean, I hate to give the guy any credit at all because he's a monster. He's going to destroy the country if he gets anywhere near the presidency. But, you know, on LGBT rights, he seems to sort of be kind of on the left-wing side of the issue. So I don't know how he threads that needle within the confines of the Republican Party, but he seems to be threading it, and the people are still cheering, giving standing ovations. So that's fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
At one point also in his speech, he made a play for Bernie Bros or whatever. He said that Bernie never had a chance. He said that the system crushed him. He never had a chance. And he said that I'm fighting for Bernie's number one issue, which was unfair trade deals. And, like, really? Was that Bernie's number one issue? I don't think that was Bernie's number one issue. It was an issue.
Uh-huh.
But number one, Donald Trump, I don't think you're going to get many Bernie supporters. That doesn't mean that they're all going to go to Hillary, but I don't think that means they're going to turn around and vote for you. I think any Bernie supporters who vote for Donald Trump would not have voted for any other Democratic candidate except for Bernie Sanders, and they only like him because he's kind of got that maverick libertarian outside the beltway vibe about him,
right?
Which is a similar thing that Trump has got going on to some degree. So, but he made a play for them in the speech, and he said what he said about LGBT, and of course he said a whole bunch of other horrible stuff.
But, right.
Were you able to watch his speech at least?
No, I haven't seen Trump's speech yet. Yeah, no, I just that was after I went to sleep and before I woke up. So, but yeah,
I'll say it was a strong speech. Like, he's a terrible guy. He believes terrible things, but I would say it was a long speech. He stayed on message. He seems to mostly have stayed on his teleprompter.
Oh, he used a teleprompter. I thought that was only for Obama.
Yeah. No. But it was. But I will say, the Republicans were with him the whole way, cheering. They cheered when he wanted them to cheer, and they booed when he wanted them to boo. They never booed him. There was no sign of the Never Trump people in the crowd that I could see. Mm-hmm. I think there was one protester who she got taken away by the security, not by Trump supporters themselves, so she didn't get assaulted by Trump supporters, which was, probably a step in the right direction. So I will say, he's a terrible person, but I think he, aside from the horrible stuff that he actually believes, aside from the lack of specificity about what he's actually going to do once he becomes president to solve the problems or how he's going to, make things better, make us great again or whatever, I think he did as good a speech as he could have done. Mm.
Yeah. Well, that's very scary. But maybe we could wrap this topic up by talking about one of the topics you wanted to talk about. We haven't gotten to yet, but Roger Ailes abbing out as the head of Fox News, and is this the kind of maybe the end of Fox News's reign? I don't know. I mean, they definitely seem to oppose Trump, and Trump seems to have risen despite their best efforts. You could say the same thing for the Republicans, the Jeb Bush wing of the party, the people that were looking for some sort of, moderate or centrist, I don't know, establishment, whatever you want to call it, candidate failed miserably. Yeah. So what do you make of all that?
Well, I think there's headlines all over the web. I saw one on the Daily Beast, and I think I saw one on CNN or somewhere that said, it's the end of the Republican Party. The Republican Party committed suicide. The Republican Party is dead and all this stuff. And, we'll see if that's true. There's obviously a big schism right now, but I have a feeling if Donald Trump loses, his brand of conservatism will be discredited and they'll try to get back on the right path.
Mm-hmm.
Quote unquote right path, as right as it ever was. But yeah, with the Roger Ailes thing, I think there's more than 20 women who are accusing him of sexually harassing them. He's been fired by Fox News, or he quit. I'm not really sure which one it was. I think he quit because he got his severance package, which was apparently like $40 to $60 million.
Mm.
But I think it started with Gretchen Carlson or something, or somebody, I forget her name exactly. And then also Megyn Kelly, obviously the big woman at the Fox News over the past couple of years, says he did it to her about 10 years ago too. Greta Van Susteren notably said she was never sexually harassed by Roger Ailes. I think Donald Trump may have done a massive amount of damage to Fox News at the same time that he's done a massive amount of damage to the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm.
He may be burning the whole thing down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
burninating the countryside and burninating the peasants.
Yes. I remember the very few times I would watch Fox News and like Fox and Friends and whatever, panel shows they would have. I was always just stunned at the sexism on display as far as the way they presented the female anchors, what the lines they gave them, the way the male anchors treated them on screen. It was just always very blatantly, you know, patriarchal and kind of horrible. So I was always like kind of taken aback every time I would flip through. I'm like, wow, people are just watching this thinking, whatever, looks good.
You know? Yeah, well, I'm sure it takes their aging base of viewership back to the good old days of the 1950s and 1960s, Mad Men, whatever.
Yeah, for
so
sure.
I'm sure Roger Ailes is shocked that, you know, his organization that he's had such an integral role in is now, you know, turning on him in this way, but
mm-hmm.
I don't know. After Donald Trump, I don't think they can survive the bad press.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. Well, was there anything else about the convention we didn't get to that you wanted to talk about?
Well, I will say, people say that Trump's kids did good jobs, but I actually didn't watch a single one of their speeches, so mm-hmm. I can't comment on that. But, yeah, I think that pretty well sums up everything I had.
Yeah. Well, it was a nightmare, and I'm glad it's over, and, you know, I'm glad there was no violence. I'm a little disappointed, as you are, that there weren't more peaceful protests, but, you know, respect to the people that did do it, you know, because that probably took a lot of courage to get in that crowd and make yourself known after what we've seen at, you know, previous Trump rallies and stuff. So, you know, I don't know if I'd have the, you know, whatever to do that, but
I mean, look what even happened to the Republicans who tried the never Trumpers on the first day there or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, they've got shouted down and bowled out of there too, so.
Right, right. Well, the Democratic one's next week, so.
Well, I'll see how much enthusiasm I can muster for that.
I doubt it'll be quite as eventful as the, I mean, it's kind of like we talked about before with the debates, you know, it was like you were saying you hadn't watched all the Democratic ones, but, you know, the Republican ones were always must-see TV, you know, because of Trump and whatever else was happening. It's like it, just people flinging their own feces at each other. So, you know, it seems like it'll probably be a little more of a traditional kind of road, you know, situation with the Democratic convention. At least that's the way it seems. Who knows? But
yeah. Well, I've heard rumors today, or I've seen them online, that Tim Kaine, the senator from Virginia, may be Hillary's VP pick.
Yeah,
like she's leaning towards him, which seems ridiculous. I mean, she lost West Virginia or something after a comment about coal, putting people in coal in a business or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And so she wants to kind of shore them up, but I don't think that that's going to have the national appeal that a Elizabeth Warren would have.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't really think, I'm not very inspired. I don't know much about most of the people that she's been considering for her vice presidential
pick. Right. But
I think she's going to go down another uninspiring alleyway here with her VP pick, but we'll see. I think within the next 24 hours, we may know that. I think she wants to announce it soon to take some of the thunder away from the Republican convention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think we should look at polls. I, from what I hear, I think that Trump and Hillary are polling pretty close right now, and I'm sure that that's mostly a bump from the convention, and it'll be interesting to see if that corrects. But Yeah, anyways, wrapping up the Republican National Convention of 2016 in Cleveland, Ohio.
Yeah, it's been one for the ages, but was there anything in Korea on your end that you wanted to get in there, either about K-pop or Korean politics?
I don't know. Bus drivers are out of control. We had a bus driver crash into some. He crashed into some cars that were going into a tunnel, and the cars appeared to be stopped, but he plowed right into them at like 107 kilometers per hour.
Mm.
And he killed four young women in their 20s, and he wounded 37 people. And he claimed that he fell asleep.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if I believe that. He claims he had dinner with some other people. He was driving a tour bus, which people like to go on these bus tours around Korea sometimes and stuff. And so he claims he had dinner with his other drivers or some other people on the staff there with his company or something the night before. He claims he didn't drink, which, if you know anything about company dinners with middle-aged men in Korea, I think he's about 57, you know that he drank.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I don't know. It's a big mess.
Mm.
So
Interesting.
So that's kind of the thing that's in the news right now, I think. But otherwise, yeah, America's going to deploy the THAAD, the THAAD anti-missile system or something to Korea, and some left-wing Koreans are protesting it, right-wing Koreans are applauding it, and they found the location where they're going to put it. Pokemon Go has not rolled out in Korea.
No.
Because Korea is one of the few countries in the world that does not allow Google Maps to provide detailed maps of the country.
No kidding.
They don't want to inadvertently give away their military installation locations to North Korea or China.
Oh my gosh.
The other day when they announced where they're putting the THAAD thing, they said, we found a location where America and South Korea will be installing the THAAD missile defense system, and it's right here in this mountain or something. Like, okay, but you just announced your missile location, and you say you can't have Google Maps in the country because you don't want to give away your military installations that are top secret.
Mm-hmm.
And in the meantime, a South Korean company says they're going to make a copycat game of Pokemon Go called Pororo Go or something like this. Pororo is a popular penguin character, children's character in South Korea. So they're basically going to do the Samsung thing and copy Apple.
Right.
Copy the popular Japanese game of Pokemon Go with a lamer Korean version to satisfy, because South Koreans are outraged that they can't play this game because they see everybody else playing it in the world.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, you've told me before that they're the most wired people in the world. Like, they have all the technology years before everyone, usually. That's just so strange. I would have thought they would have been the first in line, but that's interesting.
Yeah. Well, it turns out the people who made the game, the way they designed the map, they designed, like, these octagon shapes around the world that include the different regions.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns out that part of southeastern Korea falls under the Japanese zone,
mm-hmm.
which would normally outrage Koreans as a remnant of the colonial period or something. But people were totally booking out all the buses to go to that region because in that region they could play Pokemon Go. So one or two weeks ago, like, totally everything was booked. You couldn't get to that region of Korea because these Pokemon Go players were going out there for a day or two to play Pokemon Go as much as they could. So, I don't know. It seems like something's going to have to give there. Either they're going to have to let Google into their country, or they're going to have to make a compromise with Pokemon Go, or they're going to have to roll out this Pororo game as quickly as possible,
mm-hmm.
and probably get a lawsuit from Nintendo or Pokemon or whoever the hell is going to sue them.
Right.
I don't know.
Well, it's hard to describe how quickly this has spread in America. It's like one day it wasn't there, and then everybody was like, I went out to take the trash out one day in the apartment complex here, and I saw a guy running in his stocking feet through the grass looking panicked, and I was like, oh, does this guy need help or something? And then it took me a minute, but then I realized he was just trying to catch the Pokemon, and I was like, oh, wow, so I guess this is the world now. I guess this is what I'm going to be seeing from now on.
Yeah. Well, I'm not too proud to say I downloaded the damn thing.
Mm.
Not because I give a damn about Pokemon. I think it's stupid or whatever, but the thing is, I was just like, it's an interesting new style of video game. I enjoy video games, and I'm curious about, this augmented reality style of video game where you're in the real world, but you're also kind of in the game world as well. So I downloaded it just to see what it was about and stuff. And I went out and walked around my neighborhood for about 20 or 30 minutes. I did some exercise at the park near my house. And then I walked back. I didn't see a single damn Pokemon. And then I came back and I started Googling, like, Pokemon in Korea. And they're like, oh, it's not in Korea. What's going on? Oh, what's happening? And I started reading the news about it. I was like, oh, man. Okay, whatever. This is why we can't have nice things. So.
Right.
You posted on the status of Pokemon on the peninsula.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Try to give updates.
Yeah, for sure. Now, do you want to promote your YouTube channel at all?
Yeah, I guess the Cha's got a YouTube channel. It's called Big Daddy Cha Cha. That's capital B I G, capital D A D D Y, space C, capital C H A, capital C H A. Big Daddy Cha Cha. You can search that on YouTube, and you can find some of my videos, mostly about life in Korea, or just driving around on my bike, or showing my neighborhood, or where I live, and all this kind of stuff. And also a little bit about politics,
but not too much. I may do some more on that later. I've got a new video that may be dropping pretty soon where myself and a Korean woman from my job and her boyfriend, who speaks pretty good English, we are sitting outside of a convenience store and we eat a ghost pepper together. Mm. We have about 10 minutes of agonizing pain, so look for that to drop in the near future to Spaghetti Cha-Cha's YouTube account.
Yeah, I've.
But in the meantime, enjoy the old video.
Oh, I have been very much. Yeah, you're riding around the streets is fun. The one where you drive right by the hospital and say that, I don't forget your exact quote, but it was like, that's where you go if you happen to need to deliver a baby or something like that.
Yeah.
That was funny.
Yeah, if you get somebody pregnant, that's a hot place to go.
Yeah, exactly. That was pretty funny. And then you had one where you went to the shooting range and you busted off a few rounds.
BBs, not real bullets.
Ah.
That's all you can do in Korea. Most of the time. But yeah, good times. Short little video, lots of fun.
Yeah. So do people look at you strange when you ride by with this on your head?
A little bit, but, you know, Korea's a pretty wired country, so, yeah, not too much reaction most of the time.
That's good.
Most of the time when I'm on the bike, I'm going so fast. I actually got the chesty. There's a thing called the chesty, which is a chest mount for the camera. And I got that partially because I think it's a little bit obvious when you've got the camera on your head, but I think it would be a little bit less obtrusive or whatever if you had it on your chest at the chest level rather than sitting in the middle of your forehead. So.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's been a lot of fun. I've kind of been working so hard the past few weeks, I've kind of given up on shooting videos for a little while, but I need to get back into it.
Mm-hmm.
And I need to continue to work on improving the quality as I go. I'm not a natural video editor, and I don't have a lot of free time for this kind of stuff.
Right. Well, yeah, definitely.
But anyways, yeah. I probably better let you wrap it up here. I mean, my God, between the three recordings, how much time do we have so far?
I edited the first two last night, and I inserted a couple of clips of Stephen Colbert and Mike Pence into them. So we were already up to, I think, an hour and 20 before this, and this will be probably another hour and 20, and then I'll probably have about, 10 minutes of, music and talking and whatnot. So I think we're pushing up on being maybe the longest episode, or there in the realm, close to 3 hours. But
well, hopefully it's entertaining for people. I mean, but I think with the Republican National Convention, and to really go into, we could just mention the things that happened and give kind of a cursory overview, but I think to really get into what happened and talk about what's going on in the world, I think, especially with a week-long event like this, as well as the shootings and everything else that's been going on in America, I think it does. It is worthwhile to go into a little more depth with that. And Pokemon, too, also important.
Yeah, absolutely. But, yeah, I thank you so much for going on this journey with me, and hopefully we can do it again here soon. I'm sure there'll be much more to talk about here coming up. So.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we'll look at what we can do possibly for the Democratic Convention if you want.
Yeah, definitely. But, well, have a good night there, John. I'll talk to you soon.
All right, thanks again, Bob.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye.